To House of Reawakening Minds on this holy day. Happy Holy Day, Moors. And let us also welcome our lecturer tonight, Father Hannibal Bay. Let's receive him.
Out there in the Midwest, a little part of my golden cipher, down the south, those here in this area, especially the brothers who are here. The other Moors up there in Canaan land, peace and blessings to you. We're going to try to recap and continue some of the things that we have, but for the sake of the new students here, I want to catch them up on some things. Tonight, I definitely want to get into the demo work. Some of you who have followed know what I mean by demo work, demonstration. I'm going to teach you the basic light state hypnosis. We say little tricks or patterns to influence individuals. So these would be your little tools you use when you're operating and you're out here in this world dealing with these individuals. Because trust, it's being used on you. The old tools I've mentioned, as I said a little earlier, I always tell everybody, see the movie The Shadow. Also pull up Darren Brown. This is a cat that actually utilizes your Maya science. And he has hidden cameras that usually show him demonstrating your science. Of course, you Moors know you wearing your turbans and fezes, and you know you have the jewel that represents your pulse eye. What that usually indicates is what I'm telling you. Usually, when individuals see that, that indicates to them, you know, that yo, you can hurt them without touching. All right. I would like to open up. First off, with chapter 25 from the Circle 7 Quran, and my father and I, father would always require that we would open up the Moorish Order Roundtable meeting with chapter 25. And it's very poignant, and it's called the Holy Covenant of the Asiatic Nation. The healing, the Holy Covenant of the Asiatic Nation. You are the children of one father provided for by his care, and the breast of one mother has given you suck. Let the bonds of affection therefore unite thee with thy brothers, that peace and happiness may dwell in thy father's house. And when ye separate in the world, remember the relation that bindeth you to love and unity, and prefer not a stranger before thy own blood. If thy brother is an adversary, assist him. If thy sister is in trouble, forsake her not. So shall the fortunes of thy father contribute to the support of his whole race, and his care be continued to you all in your love to each other. And our brother had provided me a letter that the prophet always said to have read in the meeting. So this was another custom that the Moorish Order Roundtable used to read. This is the Moorish Science Temple of America, home office. 3603 Indiana Ave, Prophet Noble Drew Ali, the founder, in Chicago, Illinois. And this letter was dated January 18, 1929. This is to be proclaimed in every meeting. Dear brother, Islam, Salam, Nahilam, and Salam Alaikum. I am glad to know that I have a few faithful Moors among you all, and I desire for them to know the truth and the divine truth. There is a host of jealousy about me and the movement, now by the same people of our side of the nation that claim it was only a joke and unreal. But now, since they have found out from the government officials and the nations of the earth that this is the only sole foundation that all Asiatics must depend upon for their earthly salvation as an American citizen, they are working every scheme that they can to disqualify me so they themselves may take charge of this situation. I have notified all these things to you long ago in the past. It is through the faithful Moors that contribute to the movement and the uplifting funds. The ones that paid their divine respect to me and the movement will be remembered. That is why I'm calling upon all faithful Moors to increase their faithfulness to me, your prophet, and your divine Moorish movement. I need finance, and I need it bad. Never before have I needed finances as badly as I do at present, that I may shove aside the discord that is facing the nation. It all comes through jealousy because of my fame and notability. The nations of the world would not recognize the movement without me, the prophet, being the head. It has been proven by my work in which I have performed in the last few months, because I was at the governor's inauguration to represent the Moorish divine and national movement. And I will be at the inauguration of President Hoover for the same cause. And it has noble joy. All right, now I'm going to get into my lesson because there's so much to cover. Wow, I got some reverse mic thing here. Here we go. Now, as a recap, what I had did, I don't know if anyone has their Circle 7. It's just a quick recap. I gave the basic understanding of the chapters. I'll recap a little bit further. What I had given you Moors was what we call the Moorish Rites, first degree Moorish Rites that's in your Circle 7. And your first degree is actually Chapter 3. Alright? And that is your Enter the Apprentice. So then if you have your Circle 7, you know, mark that. And know that each degree, the basic degrees, have a basic lesson or basic statement. So your first degree, your Enter the Apprentice, that is for strength. I went into that a couple classes ago. So again, Chapter 3 in your Circle 7 Quran, which should be page 7, that's the lesson for the first degree in the Moorish Rite of Freemasonry. All right, and that is an Enter the Apprentice of the title of these. Now for your second degree, Chapter 5 is called, is for your second degree in your Moorish Rite. So again, the first degree is, you know, strength is the key word there. Now your second degree, which you would say, some would say fellow of craft, or you would say adept, right? So you mark that up above your Circle 7. And the main key phrase for that is stability. It's stability. So when you hear the Moors get to tripping, talking about, oh, I'm myself, Lord, Master, and I keep telling them, I said, no. I'm going to reach over here, so I'm going to go and pass my limit. Alright, I'm going to use this as an example. So now we're on the second degree. And again, like I said, it's Chapter 5. And it's stability. Now, like I said, you always hear somebody say, oh, I'm trying to self-loyal master. No, you're not. It's I, self-loyal, adept. One must be adept at craft before they can become a master. Right? So that is the other alternative title you use for a fellow of craft. Right? So again, that's Chapter 5. And your master degree is Chapter 7. It's Chapter 7. Right. And that basic lesson, or we say key for the master degree, is beauty. All right. We want to draw a symbol, because remember, all Freemasonry is basically, even your lessons is based off of symbology. So I'm kind of drawing a brick. And the term they would use is ashlar. All right. You're considered a brick. It's an analogy, but follow it. Another tool for say us master Masons? Is that of a trial? Right. This is the overview of it, but the side view of it will kind of look like this, and this will be the handle. Alright. Just the best I can do. But anyway, that's for those who's not familiar with tools. It's the trowel is used for when someone's laying bricks down and they take the cement and they, like, this is the brick, and then they slap it on the bricks and they smooth it out, and then they put the other brick on, and they do the same thing, and you know, smooth it, and what have you. So, this is a master mason's symbol. So you see the trowel, all it means is you're spreading the love of, what we say, the cement of brotherly love. All right, and you being the ashlar of the brick, the other symbology is, we'll say, the chisel and the mallet. And you know how you can get a rough brick off the street. And if you're building something, you know what I mean, you're getting bricks, you're going to make the smooth bricks to build it, like the house or whatever. So they use the chisel. They cut off the rough edges to make it a smooth edge. That's symbolic of you learning morals and lessons, you know, morals and ethics. Making yourself the perfect ashlar, being the perfect brick to add on to the body of the Mason. And again, you know, you keep hearing us say Freemason when we're talking about you, the nation, you wars. Because again, as I keep proving to you, that Freemason is based off of your culture. It's, they're imitating being you, like I told the brother. So, earlier we spoke a little bit when I said that when you have individuals who may be fraternity members, and they say, oh, well, who am I looking for? Traveling from the east to west, west to east. And, you know, you would say to them, well, you're looking for yourself. But basically, this is what you say is more. You say, I am he whom you seek in the east. Now, for you sisters, you know, you push your mother. So, you know, you've been there and saying, you know, mother, so, you know, I am she whom you seek in the east. Because you are the light. We're talking analogy. Remember I pointed out to you, a lot of you back in the past, I pointed out that there's two terms of Freemasonry. I put my little dictionary. So we can go into the definition. You hear the term speculative and operative. All right. I'm going to give you what they use so you can understand. All right. Here's the definition for speculative Freemasonry. The modern form of Freemasonry, which evolves as a cathedral building decline, and operative Masons began admitting non-operatives into their fraternity. All right, so in short, the speculative Freemasonry are what you see and you're well informed of what's out there now, symbology and what have you, they're speculative. You being a woke, conscious Moorish American, a Moorish national, with the ill in bay, you are the operative. You are the operative. Because again, you know, in order for individuals to hire, you know, to climb the degrees, I won't spend too much on the recapping, climb to the degrees. Of course, y'all think this is the highest degree, and it's not. There are actually higher degrees. This is just Scottish Rite. But at this degree, this is where they're introduced to your creed that you are at now, Islam, and they're introduced to your fezzes and your turbans. They have to become a 32nd degree. That's the same for the women, too. There are women in their 33rds, if you will. Right, I'll give that info later. But anyway, they're introduced to Islam, because when you become a Shriner, you have to be a 32nd degree. So as a person becomes a 32nd degree, didn't matter if they came in Baptist, Holy Roller, and they messed with snakes and stuff like that, and you know, but they came through. When they get to this higher degree, the brothers tap them and say, you want to be part of the Shrine? And they go to the Shrine, and guess what they do? They get a Holy Quran, they kiss it, they're even encouraged to go and make Hajj. And then guess what they do that you are doing on an operative level? They take on what you call Muslim names. And then they greet each other in the meetings, assalam. They'll say it in the variant, assalamu alaikum. But they're imitating you. So this is why you say, when you see them, they get tripping. You know, they like, yeah, because I'm, you know, heavy stuff and high degree stuff. And you're like, mm-hmm. You sitting there with your feathers on your trip, like, mm-hmm. That's why I'm even you seeking your needs. Mm-hmm. All right, so it's not tripping. You know what I mean? But they truly are imitating you. I'm only recapping. Tonight we're going to go into demonstration. I know some of you probably kept up on the web. I want to this time do demos and start teaching you more mechanics in the light hypnosis thing. I want to make sure each of you know how to do it, give you patterns. Matter of fact, I want to ask if some of you, the old ones I hadn't seen in a while, have anybody completed the 30-day hypnotic gaze training? No. It'll take some time, but you know, one time I asked, remember I said you have to, if you did try it, you wave your head so I know you're not bull crapping. I did say you have to memorize the whistling first.
Right.
You don't want to, you know, once you memorize it, then you do it. I'm going to, for the sake of doing this here, I was explaining to you before, and I'm going to give this pattern. The hypnotic gaze training takes, you would have to have a timer, a personal mirror, and make sure you're quiet, so no one can disturb you. There is a little pattern, meaning a phrase or affirmation that you're going to have to repeat over and over. It takes a month for the training. And you want to start out with the first week. Take a good 5 minutes of your time doing this. So, whack as though this is my personal mirror and no one's bothering me. And I have my personal mirror and I'm making sure that I can see it. And you want to get something to kind of make a little dot between the third eye. Because that's going to be your focus. That's going to be your focus point. Before I go any further, so you can understand this, the things I am giving you, the science I'm giving you that I'm breaking down to you, so some individuals cost thousands of dollars, and it's a well-kept secret among master hypnotists and master magicians. So what I'm kind of saying to you, this is an art that your old ancestors taught, but you had to go to higher school to get it. And this is why the Magician's Guild, a lot of your secrets and stuff is held there. Now, a lot of you travel, try to visit the Magic Castle out here in Cali. It's a depository where all the magicians go. Matter of fact, they had it in the movie Lord something. Came out in 95. What was this movie? Lord of Illusions. It was in the movie Lord of Illusions. So, what I'm giving you is a training, again, once you complete this, you'll have such a great hypnotic gaze that people can't look you in the eyes, especially if they're trying to lie. Any vicious animal will not look you in your face. Maybe one day we all chill. You know, I would like to one day have this where we go out and have an alley where we all walk and do our prayer walk like I usually describe. And maybe one day, you know, you always walk by somebody's yard and they got a vicious dog. And I'll just show y'all real quick and I'll just sit there and stare and be like, they won't look me in the face. They won't look me in the face. No, it's not like low down dirty Shane, where Shane had the dogs and he said, ooh, ooh. I'm gonna bite this on the head. You know, I was just looking at that. But, you know, what I'm talking about is actual alpha and beta, how can I say, universal function that happens between people. There's always going to be in a group of people an alpha person, and there's always going to be a beta. The alphas are your leaders, betas are followers, and you'll have a little lowest deltas and all that. But what I am telling you is a secret that all leaders go to sacred schools for. Mainly preachers, they call it hooping classes. They learn certain secrets to mesmerize and spellbound their constituents. So anyway, going back to the example, the statement you're gonna wind up staring in the mirror at the spot that this is when maybe you've got a girlfriend and get one of her little eye markers and stuff. Don't let her know because you know, they don't like messing with your makeup, but that'd be kind of good because then you can wipe it off. But you want to just draw a little dot between your third eye. That's your focal point. So for 5 minutes, you want to repeat the verse over and over and over while you're staring without blinking. without blinking. And here is the basic verse, and maybe you can get with some of the others, they would be with me. It says, the power of my mind and will is tremendously strong. My willpower is overwhelming to everyone. Nobody can resist me. No one ever attempt to do bad against me or around me, because the people who respect me, love me, fear me. I'm going to add that little piece in there, but basically want to say, because I can instantly mesmerize, I can instantly charm, I can instantly hypnotize everybody. And that'll be a verse you just repeat over and over and over and over. Now here's the key, this is when you know you're doing something right. When you're staring, your eyes are going to smart, so meaning if they want to tear, don't worry about that. Don't worry about that, they want to tear. The key thing is to continue to stare without blinking. Once you complete, as soon as you blink, you got to start all over. But for that whole week, you should be able to accomplish it 5 minutes straight without blinking. And you want to feel great by the end of the week. You want to complete it. Then when you start the second week, now you want to do it for 10 minutes straight. Complete that. Once you do that in your third week, you want to do it 15 minutes straight. And by the time you hit the fourth week, you're going to be staring in the mirror, repeating that verse for 20 minutes straight without blinking. Once you complete that, trust that hypnotic gaze will come in handy. It is a basic tool to all, even master hypnotherapists, just as well as stage hypnotists. So some of the stuff I'm going to show you tonight is what they call stage hypnotist secrets, along with, like I said, wake state, because I'm trying to build up to get to that. The sister is moving forward with some of the literature that I have to give you. So I just want to check on that. Get notes with everyone on that, and we'll move a little further. So going back to, like I said, the master level of Freemasonry, you know, you are the operative, so meaning you utilize the spiritual just as well as the material knowledge of it. This is where your Hex Alpha come in, or the original name is Ab-Ab, A-A-B-O-B, Ab-Ab, that's the original Lemurian name called. All right, so that's a little quick recap, and we're going to keep this going. Boy, it is hot up here. All right, but that's on full. That's on full blast.
It is. I can move it up on this side.
I mean, I think I can kind of listen, but I know if I was sitting out there.
This is cool.
I would be, you know, dude's cool, but it's hot. Like, okay. I'm just recapping, but I'm going to move in. Again, some of the things that we talked about, you can catch on the class that the sister recorded and put up. And I actually told Dr. Nala L, I said, yeah, I seen the person that put it up on YouTube and cut somebody out and said something negative to me. I went in on in my stink meter voice from Boondocks. Oh yeah, I had to go in. I was calling Fruity Pebbles, Booty Warrior, Peter Puffer, I was calling DJ. And I'm like, I got children, I don't even go that way. I made them feel stupid. And then I always put parentheses in my stink meter voice. But you know, but I like when I get them live, because I can do the voices too. Anyway, what we were talking about, again, last guest, I gave the secrets of that. Here's the other secret I gave of the Quran, too. Again, this is just recap, and then we're going to really go in. I have brought up chapter 23, and you all know that one of your old science, your war science, is astrology, right? All right. And so the Circle 7 is full of, chock full of deep science, deep secrets that the brother prophet had given you. And This lesson, me and my father, it was a joy to always bring this to Morris. Well, hidden in chapter 23 is the lesson that you give to the children of your zodiac. So, again, this is a recap, so I'm not going to read everything. I'm just going to get to the point. So, chapter 23, which is the holy instructions for thy children, starting at verse 8, where it says, teach him obedience, and he shall bless thee. That part of the sentence there is to a child who is born of Aries. All right, that should be your page 35 in your circle 7. Now, the second part of verse 8 is to teach him modesty, and he shall not be ashamed. That is for a child that is a Taurus. So that's my son's son. Right. Now, verse 9, teach him gratitude, and he shall receive benefits. This is the lesson that is taught to a Gemini child. So make your notes in your circle 7s there. And the second part of 9 is teach him charity, and he shall gain love. That's the lesson that is basically taught to a Cancer child. Now, again, just because I'm saying children, remember, we all children too. You know, when Prophet Jarali, you know, came on the scene, you know, dealing with grown men and women, we're still children. So, you know, there's always this thing, oh, I'm going to give this to my child. It's a lesson for us too. Verse 10, teach him temperance, and he shall have health. This is a lesson to a child that's born under the sun sign of Leo. The second part.
Excuse me.
Yes.
I think I saw that lesson as Virgo.
No. The first part of 10. That was the second part. Yeah, so verse 10, the first part is teach him temperance. Shall have faith, have health. That's the first part of verse 10. And then the second part is for the Virgo, teach him prudence, and fortune shall attend him. So you were right, it was just the second part of that verse. And the verse 11 is teach him justice, and he shall be honored by the world. That's a lesson you teach a child who is a Libra. And the second part of that is teach him sincerity, and his own heart shall not reproach him. That's a lesson taught to a child born under Scorpio. Verse 12, teach him diligence, and his help and his wealth shall increase. That's a lesson is taught to a Sagittarius child. The second part of verse 12, teach him benevolence, and his mind shall be exalted. That's a lesson to a child who is a Capricorn. In the last verse, 13, teach him science, and his life shall be useful. That's the sign, that's for the sun sign of Aquarius. That's my father and my two biological babies. And the last of the 13, the last portion is teach him religion, and his death shall be happy. That's the lesson of a Pisces child. So for those who already had that, they're already covered. This is just a recap portion here. So that was part of this, the things that we covered there. Now, I did go into another use of holy words, or we say the lost words, and I just gave Dr. I have a master's, so you can run it off. It was the green book. I forgot I had it in white, so I meant to hand you that, so we can run that off too. Again, I thank y'all so much for being patient. A lot of the books and literature and stuff is being copied now. We just got to do a little ink issue, but it's a lot of stuff that I'm giving you is going to be available to you. So, anyway, the word was Mara. It was just a variant of what I gave you, Rama. Again, these words seem, you know, a little, you know, like, but trust, these words are power words. I had just discussed with some of you before that just because, you know, you're saying some words, it might seem weird or whatever, trust, they have power behind them. You have power behind your intent, whether you're conscious of it or not. We're going to go into the Corvette. Even though I went into the history last week, what was it? Lemuria, when we finally arrived, I finally read that piece. But the main message that the Creator was giving you throughout the Holy Corvette is to let you know you are God. The reason why you are God, and understand this, and I'm making it simple and to the point. If you are the child of the Creator said, I create everything. Everything outside of me is God. I am not God. I am the Creator. The Creator creates to survive. And the Creator always creates things, and then it will create to even make it more perfect. That's just the way of things. But it's going to be more clear once you, or some of you who do have a Holy Corvette in your hand. But here's the key thing. You're a God because you're the only God, and there is no other. Doesn't matter if you have a twin. You have the same power the Creator has. This is what you lost. This is what we all lost. This is just a power word, so, but I'm going to tell you again, a lot of this is recap. This is the power the Creator called, that it gave you, that it has. Oxa power. It says it's your God power. You have a seed of it within you. We all have it. We all came from the Creator. You're all the Creator divine. You all came from it. So it's no different than, like I used the example before, and everyone answered, if I am the king, and you are my children. So what would that make you by birth? If it's a woman child, what?
Princess.
And if it's a boy child?
Prince.
And unfortunately, when the time comes, I lay my form down, he then becomes
king.
And lay my form down, and the daughter becomes
queen.
You understand? So if they're royalty by birth, you're divine. By birth creation. This is why the Creator said you're God. You got to this planet and you traveled from different galaxies to here and other places on thought power. I read another part of the Holy Corvette giving up the names of the actual planets and certain things, so I might go into that a little bit today, but I really want to get into the demo because I want to start giving you more tools about what I'm doing tonight. Alright, so I'm just trying to get to the point that once you walk out the Holy Corvette, you read it, and we're going to keep going through. But the key message the Creator is saying, Corvette is Lemurian. All it means is words of the Creator. Right? The key thing is the Creator wants you to know your thought powers are very powerful. The basic tools that I'm crunching down and giving to you on point, just crunching it, but you'll get the literature and say, all right, boom. All right, see what brother man did. To make it on point is to make you understand this. You're so powerful, even in your sleep form, your wake state sleep form, you affect the web. You affect your environment. Again, I'm not taking it as though you don't know, because a lot of you already, you being this far, you know this knowledge. So just take what I'm giving you to fill in. I'm not trying to insult you. I know you all have this knowledge. I'm just giving you more and probably filling in what you already know anyway. But the key thing is to know this, your thought power is very powerful. I'm going to try to demonstrate this tonight, and I want to make sure that all of you understand this, especially those out there in TV land.
Yes.
I know everybody's taking some of the science, and that's good, but I want you to do good with it. But it will be a time I'm going to have to get to the point where me and Dr. Nala Ill want to do. There's some things I want to give you that I can't let. Y'all know. Some of you that know me, it's more to give you. You know what I'm saying? Especially when you get more of the Magi work, you understand why I give you the first portion of the Holy Corvette. It's easy access. But normally the second part and the higher pieces is when one gets initiated. Because our science or our priesthood is based off of the Peru, meaning the whole. So that means the formulas and things and techniques we're giving you, you can develop it, but if that person has a dark heart, they can also do damage with this knowledge. You already know that, so I'm not going to preach to the choir. You know what I mean? You already know that. You already see what we're dealing with. You already know we're all being oppressed by those who have your more science. They've got your government, they're using their metaphysics, and they're killing you behind. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is the Peru symbolic of the movie with Iron Man? Mm-hmm. That power source in his chest.
Mm. Well, yes and a no. You know what I mean? Yes and a no. You know, but it's good that you're equating it. A lot of things that you're saying, yeah, it's symbolic. But the key thing is to know that your thought power is very powerful. Like right now, I can change the tone of my voice. I'm changing my frequency. I can now lull you into more of a calmer state. And if I keep on this, for I know that a lot of you will just start feeling more relaxed. Your eyes feel heavy. Start sinking down in the chair. But I won't do it. Had to break it because in a way you were sliding into it. But I won't do it. And matter of fact, did you not jump a little bit when I did that? Tell the truth.
Yes.
All right. That's good because I had covered, there's four brain waves. Since we're going in there, because I really want to get into the demo. Remember I told you it's four brain waves or four consciousness. We'll just go into that. Mainly I broke it down into three. And I said it's the conscious mind, the critical mind, and the modern mind. Your conscious mind remembers about an hour and a half. Your critical mind, remember I said that's the bridge between, I don't feel like right on the board, I'm horrible about that. But to make it simple, your conscious mind is your left side of the brain. So all y'all looking here, this here is basically what you're working with right now. Your left side is your conscious mind. Your subconscious mind is here, your right side of the brain. Your critical mind is the bridge that's in between. So if somebody's giving you a suggestion, whether you believe in it or not, it goes through its filter. Your filter is the gate, whatever you want to call it, that's the critical mind. That's the state and where an idea sits for 24 hours. This is where your sleep comes in. Your sleeping or your resting is where you're processing. You're processing, and it's just a matter of if you're going to accept the ideas or not. And then it would make its way into the subconscious mind. Now remember when I said, I'm just making it very simple and plain. The subconscious mind is like the Incredible Hulk. Strong as I don't know what. I don't want to say stupid. You just have to talk to it. It's like a 3-year-old. So this is what I tell you when you're trying to change something. Put it into a small sentence. And then repeat that. And try to etch that in your mind. You're talking to your subconscious mind. This is what psychics do to be able to see things, to feel. Your feds represents your pyramid, the storehouse of knowledge. The key thing, and this is straight across the board with any religious organization, will teach you tools just to go within your subconscious mind to tap into that God blueprint that's on your DNA to awaken. That's all. Even if you had an ascended master sitting here right now, we're giving you some things that may seem like it's new to you. Some of you may recall. This one student I want to get here, he's from... He moved from New York, now he's in PA, this cherub, Raphael Bay. And he's a young cherub, mid-20s. He just started drawing, and the man draws like nobody's business, and he just started a year ago. He's gonna eventually get here, very talented. And he's the one I mentioned to y'all that he took some of the lessons, because he is in my cypher, so he talks to me sometimes over text. And he used just some of the tools I gave you, and his spirit is growing. He just told me the other day, in his spiritual work that I have given him, he wound up contacting one of our ancestors that told him how he was one of the ones who had to try to protect the Holy Corbeth and other lessons in order for it to survive in his death. You're going to meet him. His name is Raphael. He's going to eventually get here. So he's probably watching now. So, but anyway, I don't want to leave on that tangent. So, your subconscious mind is basically you going in it to pull out old information. And when you have that ability, you'll be able to then unlock other things. This is where the science of Nalva comes in and Ishmatai. I just basically broke these down. Again, this is recaps. The Nalva is the science of complete and total union with all things. I spoke to Cherub Osiris, and we were talking about it, so I'm going to break it down to you, basically. You will get this energy. Some of you know me personally. I just texted to you, but we're trying to get the hard copies in hand. All Nalva is being what you call in a meditative state and releasing your spirit into all creation. But first you have to start out because you're starting. So they always say you start out with a plant. You release your spirit and you put your spirit into the plant. And if you're doing it correctly, you should be then looking back at yourself. And then when you do it enough, you should be able to then, in multiple times, looking at yourself and other people, seeing yourself if you're out in the yard, seeing yourself on the blade of grass or the grinding on sand, looking up at yourself just as well as in the cloud, looking down upon yourself. This is part of the ritual that you do on the days that everybody's talking about, oh, the Luminante, oh, June 21st, the day of summer, and they do the ritual because the blood of sacrifice, you know, the Luminante. You know, Tupac told you when he was like, oh, and Biggie went, oh, you know, and you know, because it is real, man. Your ancestors used the Nalva of blending your spirit with all creation. And every time that you do that ritual, you augment, you strengthen your spiritual power. So some of the stuff you see in the martial art movies, they go, sham. Breaking bricks and stuff like that, flying and stuff like that. You actually did that. It's not saying you can't. It's changing your perception. The movie The Matrix was a very, very poignant movie. Because the whole thing is, you look at life as, and I was an old video game player. I never bought a video game without finding code first. I hate losing. When they bought The Matrix out, I was no more than about a few years in my priesthood as a magi. I said, oh my gosh, here's something to change your perception when I'm going through this. Look at the world as a construct. Look at the world as a matrix. Look at the world as a video game. Just try to find the binary code that changed the abilities. Because again, what did he say to Neo? He said, get rid of fear, doubt, free your mind. Fear, doubt, and disbelief, you change your perception. So when you see videos of individuals doing miraculous things, guess what they did? I just gave it to you in quick form. They just changed their perception. They just broke the binary code, which everybody keeps telling you this life is a simulation. So if it is, then all right, now I'm telling you my secret. I'm looking at it, I'm looking for the binary codes. Yes, sir.
So with the Nalva, when we look at something and then project ourselves into the something and then just looking back at ourselves.
Can you wait for the mic?
What is the power? What is the power beyond what I just described? Now that I'm looking back at myself from this plant, what strength am I? What's my goal? What am I trying to do with that?
You're awakening your other side abilities. This is where Ishmatai comes in. One of the very few, and it depends on individuals, because everyone is different. Just me giving this knowledge, and I'm an older man now, a grandfather, and these young cherubs here, they take this knowledge, and they use it. They may open up and activate an ability that we have. So one of the abilities you will do, for one, your perception will change. Your sensing of people, meaning you can sense when someone's coming. that's another part of a norm. You, once you do it enough, you know what I mean, you're starting to be connected. Did not Prophet Joel gave you your five principles of your love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice? And when you, and what's your first principle? Love. And when you deal with love, where is that generally generated?
Heart chakra.
That from the heart. So when you do that, trust, certain senses and abilities kick in. Like, for instance, I was able to, you know, influence people more. Another person can be able to heal. Another person can't think of this. I can't say these babies' names in India. You know, they got the long name. All that. I can't say it. Please, baby, I think she's a sweet little child. She's about as young as that little girl. Now she's about 12. She was 9. This little girl, they can sit up there. She did a science close to normal. I will give it to the video to some of y'all. Anyway, you could put a blindfold on this baby and you give her that book. And you turn that page and she'll read it. With the blindfold on. You see? Beautiful little East Indian girl. Looked like one of my babies when she was young. That's just one of them, beloved. But I know you already know that. Me and you talk, you do that so the people, you know, so I thank you so much. Me and him, we go back like the old Cadillac before flat. You know what I'm saying? You know, puff, puff. So, but he does that because of, you know, and I thank him so much. But that's just one of the abilities. Then you might have somebody that will do telekinesis. Then you might have somebody that does what we all call old science of astral travel. And of course, like I say, European takes their stuff and reinvent it, rename it, and ain't gonna call it remote viewing. We call it astral travel. So it's many other talents that come out of it. And then some of the other stuff that you see your Oriental brothers, you know, like one brother can take a piece of paper and crumble it, and then he can sit there and focus. And this thing, you know, it bursts into flame. And I think I mentioned to y'all, if one of the tests for me to go higher, I'm a grand priest, I'm only a patriarch. But to become a caliph, which is two ranks above me in the grand priesthood of this Magi, we think it's a point we're doing our oxen power, doing certain things. And one of the tests, from what I've heard, is when we have to put a piece of paper on fire under a rock, under water. But I know you only have, and I thank you so much for that. You know, because we always go back and forth.
That's why I can't think, but I love you, man. But, man, you know what I mean? I mean, man, you know, same time, man. Same time, man.
So, but that's what that does. Now, Ishmatai, there's a manual for that. This one is quick. It's number one, about 7 pages. We just got to get a copy to you. Like I said, some of you were in my cipher. I sent it to you, but we're now starting to be able to get hard copies to you, but I'm just giving it to you, the basic of it. That's what's done on the days the seasons change. June 21st, summer, September 21st, December 20th, you know what I mean? And then what you don't know is there is an apex in the seasons. So when you had your Morse or your Lemurian New Year, you call it Morse New Year, January, March 21st, that was spring. The apex of that, meaning the height, meaning the sun is very potent, the creator's energy is potent on the planet, is May 1st. And then so the apex of summer is August 1st. And here's where we get lost, and this is why I call the beast religion, this was the original name that we call Christianity, because we foretold if Christianity was going to come about 2,000 years prior. Called the beast religion. This is where I now call them Saul of Satan, and I'll tell you why. Because everybody keep claiming they love God and everything, but then mighty funny, they celebrate Halloween. And I think I broke it down to some before, but I'm saying for sake of new individuals here. When you're in fall, September 21st, but what got lost was the apex of that day, of that fall or autumn, is actually November 1st. And it's also called All Saints Day. And you will find out in the Holy Corbett, the Creator has everything in order. And the Creator said, your saints are your governors. So this is where your ancestors, we fell away from the Creator and we kept taking the angels and making them gods, and that's how the different religions came about. But you still nonetheless took time to give respect to the governors that are in heaven, which is the saints. And that's why you had All Saints Day. You gave respect to the angels in them because you call them all year to help you and do whatever. You must give respect. Now, the point I'm going to say here is this. Remember I said the Creator's energy is paper. It's a blending of positive and negative. So now, to help you understand, the day before November 1st, which you all know is Halloween, but it was called Hallows Eve. Now, what I'm about to talk about real quick, all this is recap. We're now talking about the left-hand path. See, what you're following right now is the right-hand path. The left-hand path, people know that the Creator's energy is paper or balance. Neutral, meaning it can go either way. So whenever there is a holy day, guess what them Satanists and all them do? They gather, what, at least the 94th, they want to partake of the energy too. So that's why they then, if this is November 1st, this is why then the night before they're doing their rituals and human sacrifices. Yeah, and, oh, and don't eat at McDonald's. I know they probably don't do me like they did do me either. Yeah. Go ahead and do some stuff. I'm saying it because, real quick, let me do this as a little PSA. Don't eat at McDonald's because I thought my dad was joking. Well, we don't joke, but we drop knowledge. He sent me this video a couple years ago by this Ashkenazi rabbi, and I thought it was a joke. Daddy sent me the video. Man, I can't think of his name. Rabbi Shmuley, something like that. He's like, oh, yeah, he's being interviewed by a Christian. So he said, so you a synagogue of Satan? Like, yeah, he said, why are you being so bold? Because we got bold power. Now I'm hearing him talk like that. I'm thinking, oh, this is a joke. So I'm sitting there, you know, it's like almost an hour, something like this. I'm waiting for the joke because he's literally, yes, and you know, and we tell all Jews, you only have McDonald's. He said, all right, well, since you are synagogue of Satan and you sacrifice people, what do you do with the dead bodies? He said, that's why we don't have McDonald's. We have meat packing places, and McDonald's is one of our big customers. See, some of y'all are young. You ain't heard of the movie from the early 70s called Soylent Green. Heck, it was even in the Matrix. When Morpheus said, I watched the bodies be liquefied and fed to the dead intravenously. And there's a video I need to pull out. They did, it's a series called The Stuff They Don't Want You to Know. They finally did research on people that were cannibals and the effects of when they eat human body. It happens in stages. First, they call it the laughing disease. They laugh uncontrollably. And within a few years after that, they start losing control of the body, and after that, they do die. So yeah, eating the human body is not good. So now that kind of makes me wonder why I look on YouTube, I see all these fight videos. I wonder why all my people fighting at McDonald's all the time. They ain't want food to eat. So had to do the little PSA thing. Please, do not smoke in both the cars. All right, now I'm going to say that. So, but I had to say that. You know. So anyway, so the Satanists, they use these holy days to gain the power because the Creator's energy is very, very potent on that day, on the apex of the day. But also the same thing when the seasons change. All right, and of course you already know, you Moors, you know your astrology, so I just want to tell you that. Now, the four brain waves, remember I told you there's alpha, beta, theta, and delta. You all familiar with that? The alpha is the wake state. But this is where your brain waves are kind of you kind of lose your individuality. Beta state is where you're at right now. All right, but I'm going to explain alpha so you can understand this, and then you can understand why it's dangerous to have a leader on the mic. And if somebody's going to have a public meeting, they always have to go to the city and apply and get a permit. All right. Right now, you're functioning on your beta brainwave, meaning you have your individuality, you're thinking, you know, you're not part of the hive mind. But this happens naturally. When you get a great group of people together, especially like if you go to concerts and things like that, your brain wave is still functioning because you're awake, but it slows down and slides into an alpha state, meaning you're in a suggestible state. Here's another point so you can understand. You ever hear some people that got caught up in a riot? You're like, yeah, man, I don't know, man. They were just smashing stuff. I don't know. And I just got caught up, man. I don't know, man. I was, wow, man, they were smashing. So I had to do what everybody else was doing. Mm-hmm. What it was is they got caught in their main mindset or the hive mind. And they were in a wake state, hypnosis state, if you will. And they wind up doing what other people are doing. Only individuals who keep their individuality, who does not let their mind slide into the alpha state and they stay beta, will not get caught up in the hive mind. All right. But also, you know, again, the alpha is kind of like, again, not a slight psychic, but mainly a theta state is. That's the state that when you just woke up from sleeping or just about to go into sleep, that's the state of mind that a lot of individuals who are psychics and they want to tap into to see the Akashic records or do other things spiritually. So that's that there. All right. Now, last time we spoke, I have finally went into the Holy Glorbeth, going into the history of when you came here onto this planet. And it was actually book 5. And we're going to touch that real quick. Because I need to keep touching on the mind.
Question.
Yes.
Just the last state, Delta.
Delta. Oh, the Delta state. Of course, that's your sleep state. That's your deep, deep sleep state. You know. Also, know this. When you hear people say hypnosis, it's really not a sleep state. You're actually the person that's actually conscious. Have to be conscious, because usually in the sleep state, your mind is in a suggestible state, meaning it's only feeding off of its own inner thoughts. But if someone's a skilled hypnotist and they come across someone that is asleep, they can stimulate you and wake you up enough to then send you back under, but you would appear like you're sleeping. And then that's what we call a hetero suggestion, and then they're sliding the suggestions in when you're sleeping. The Army kind of worked with that suggestion. This is just a little tool here, whereas they had soldiers, they actually did this. They were in another country and they needed to learn a different language. So this is that back in the day, you babies are probably saying, what's a record player? So they had record players that had language to speak like French or something, and they put it under the bed of the soldiers and they would play it while they were sleeping. And they found out that the soldiers absorbed the information quickly and were able to learn lessons. So now I'm giving you a key, something that us magi or sages use. So whenever you go to rest and you're trying to change something on your body or know something or develop a new part of the character in you, think about it, focus on it. I'd say, wait before you go to bed, sit down and write things that you want to achieve. And then take one of them at a time. And purposely, as you lay your head down for the night, you keep repeating it, that I want to yada yada, as you go off to sleep. Do it for 30 days. Let it be the first thought when you go on the rest, and then let it be your first thought when you wake up. Yes.
Islam, would it be better to, instead of saying something that you want to do, to say it in more of an affirmative, I am, or I am a such and so, I will, I am, because want kind of has a lingering kind of need to want something, I mean, to get something, obtain something that you never...
You got to desire.
You have to desire. Right. It's a higher vibration to desire than to want. And I attribute that to something that Dr. B. Sirius taught when he came and did the workshop. He was specific about even the way want sounds versus desire.
Right. And she's actually correct. Yes. The key thing is to plan out. Target, focus on what you want to correct yourself to, what your characteristics. And it does. It does.
Islam.
Yes. All right, the part that I kept saying for weeks is on actually the page 16, and a lot of you kept hearing me talk about, I'll go back and forth with the mind and the history, just recapping, but I'm trying to get back to the mind and I'm going to start doing demonstrations. I finally read directly from the Holy Gurbet the history that you kept hearing me telling you, the so-called Garden of Eden and Adam and Eve. They got that from the Holy Gurbet. The Holy Gurbet is the mother of the Bible and the Quran. This was the book that was being burned during the Crusades. Again, that's this for those who are out there. This, out there. This was a book that was burned through the Crusades, and this is who you were way before you became Muslims. You are the original, what they call Jews. That was your symbol. You took this faith and your creed and your knowledge to all corners of the world from under this seal. And that wasn't the only seal that represented you. It was also the Ankh and also the winged scepter. You went to Europe. They were known as Druids. You went into Kemet. They called themselves the Coptics. You even were here in a lot of the creed that you know they didn't put under the history of so-called Native Americans, which you already know is us, the Mormons. Well, when I told the history of Abam and the Lemurians that you had left your home planet Aden and you came here with about these 3,000 people, and book 5, that's page 16 of the Holy Corbett, I'll just recap. Sore once, as in the beginning of the earth, there were no humans upon the land, but the animal people ruled the earth. And Sore 2 said that there was a planet called Aden, that's A-D-E-N, that was your home planet. Remember, I always keep saying in short, keep going in history, excuse me, with the comic books, and I say, you know, that whole Superman story, that's them telling your history. Yes.
The animal people ruled the earth.
Yeah, well, I jumped a little bit, but if you go into the beginning of the part of the Holy Corbett, the Creator is letting you know that all things are equal, because it all came from the Creator. So the Creator is saying, so they are fish people, rock people, animal people, grass people, flower people, all things are people, all things have intelligence. We're the only one that lost that consciousness. Like, for instance, the higher pieces of the Holy Corbett would tell you, because obviously our ancestors communicated with the plants. We call them plants. They themselves call themselves octoretrogrades. So, again, you know, all we're doing here is just uncovering the Prophet Jawali. As said, you know, the mothers and fathers of civilization. You know what I mean? So, but it's good that you pointed that out, you know, but we're just in the middle part of it, but that needs to be said, because I did start at the beginning, and I just wanted to get to this part, because it's going to dispel the whole Adam and Eve story, because this is the Adam and Eve story that they changed up. But yeah, the Creator said, in my eyes, all things are equal, and that those who are traveling on the path of becoming a god, or we just say masters, but outside of our faith, others will say ascended masters. I may give you all a taste too. We have a brother who
actually became an ascended master. I'm going to have to backtrack for you new brothers and sisters. In your faith, this faith, the Hittian faith, that's what we actually call Hittian, meaning the knowledgeable people of God. But you outsiders of the faith call us the Essenes, the Gnostics, the Magi, the king or queen priests. These are the different names we were called. In our faith, we're the only faith on this planet that we have many ascended masters. So following the prescribed training takes many years. Some Hittians may have went to the grave and not achieved it. Some haven't. There are still Hittians that are still alive when the prophet had actually gave the teaching. And one of his names is Homak Pol. So I may read a little bit to your he was the only ascended master, meaning he became a god and immortal. He was the only one who wrote a book on how it felt. So I think I will do that tonight. I hope I will read that so you can get that. Because I've disposed this to some of my students already. So I'll do that for the sake of those out here. So you can understand. Because that's the basic goal. Even if we were Christians, even if we were Buddhists, or what have you, ultimately, if you're following the faith, people are trying to get back to God, but a lot of times they don't tell you how. Getting back to God, meaning the Creator, is actually that path. You're becoming immortal. There's one thing you'll hear in the Holy Corbett. The Creator said, I've made you to live 1,000 years. You don't even choose to live 1/10 of it. And I always use a little piece from the Marvel movie of Thor when Loki was standing in front of Odin. He said, we're gods. And Odin said, we're not gods. We were born, we live, we die. He said, yeah, give or take 5,000 years or so. At the time you did that, that's what made you God. You just fell from that consciousness. Now you're trying to make your way back to that. We may not reach it. Some of us, or maybe one of us do, but these little ones, they have a greater potential that they can take this knowledge. They're not caught up with a lot of bad ideas, meaning negative thoughts and doubts, disbeliefs. And their karma is cleaner. And they follow the prescribed training and stuff that I give to y'all, lean to y'all, and I trust I'll be able to divulge a lot of this to y'all while you be initiated before the time comes and I lay my form down. And well, we know it. These babies become immortal. I know what I wanted to give y'all and show you. There is a very important person in history. You don't have to move your camera, just keep that there. Because we're talking about immortals. And a lot of you have seen this, and this is good because I know I have made a copy. We're talking about immortals. And I mentioned this, now I brought a picture. This woman is called Queen Tay. Some Moors will tell you she's a Moor. They found this bust in Kemet, what you call Egypt. She's not Egyptian. She's Lemurian. This is Queen Tay. Queen Tay is an ascended master, and she is still alive today. Thank you, Lord. See, I told you how we work. Man, come on, man. Give me one. Oh, you want me? All right, man. Thank you. So, I'm going to make sure y'all get a copy of that. Because I'm talking about Homak Pol, but I had to make something so y'all can see. Now, there's a guy named David Childress, a European, who was doing a lot of your Moorish artifact and history and uncovering stuff, and he actually found that out. And in our sacred orders, like I said, we had at least 7 of them that gave you lessons, that left lessons in the Holy Corvette. Because there's basically 7 paths of masterhood. They give you, you know, some little general knowledge of what you do, whatever, the right love, you know, yada yada. But I wanted y'all to see that. That's Queen Tet. Now here's another piece of the backstory. She attained ascended mastership, they said, through the Tantra science. We have babies here, so you know what I'm saying? It's the horizontal mambo, so I don't have to say babies here. All right. child was born, the child was supposed to be in the womb. So the three of them are existing in the sacred cities, the Lemurian cities underground. All right? So I had to show you that. So pass around, y'all looking. I know y'all got your phones and y'all take pictures and stuff. Make sure that's circulating. But that is the real deal right there, where people thought she was Egyptian because they found that in an Egyptian room. And they found she ain't Egyptian. And she kind of looked like Pam Grier. I used to date her sister, kind of looked like her. Yeah, I used to feel it. Brown sugar. Man, I said, that's good. She looks like it too. And she looked just like Pam Grier. I want to grow up to marry that woman. Anyway, so she's in one of the sacred cities. Now, some of you Moors who go to the temple, you hear about, you'll say, more sacred cities under the ground. Well, we can already get into this part right here. Sura 2 says, there was a planet named Aden by which the Amalgians and the Lemurians, so those are the two main nations. The Amalgians were the father nation of you Lemurians, because you're Moors because you're descendants of Lemurians. That is your purebred state of who you were, all right? We're Moors because of the Yaqub experiment. Yaqub was a Lemurian. Yaqub Cacatius Cushitis was a Lemurian. And he had 12 Lemurian scientists. So when you're reading it in the circles of, the clock of destiny, and they're saying Moors, it wasn't Moors, it was Lemurian. But nonetheless, they gave you the truth. But you became Moors, the Moabite nation, when he created the new people. And then they were called the children of Israel. So even like I told you, you run into Israel people out there in the street, don't get in an argument with them, you just tell them, brother, you're saying Moors, same way, you just recognizing the father that created the fourth nation. Because remember, Yaqub. And Moru Akain Il was his father. And he said, when you get such a great job, I will now name you Israel. And this beautiful bouquet of children will be now known as children of Israel. All right? So, I want to go into this because I want you to hear where you then, this is where the civilization began on the underground. All right, so there was a planet called Aden by which the Amalgians and Lemurians were in power. The Luktits and the Ulaaks went to war against the Amalgians and Lemurians. These were other nations on your home planet, Aden. Those of you who get the Holy Korbeth, you'll see where I kept saying, this is where the Ashkenazis, you call Yiddish, made their Superman. They took and stole your story, sold it back to you in comic books. And they still didn't even hide it from you. Because I always ask people, what was Superman's real name?
Kal-El.
And yeah, they all say, Clark can't be like your Kal-El, put it right in your face. Kal-El. And it was a time he was drawing brother's complexion with dark eyes and dark hair. Alright, so anyway, and their weapons were as powerful as the sun, and they destroyed the planet and had to flee in great ships. Sura 3, only 3,000 of the people of Aden made the journey to Earth. So we're the descendants of the 3,000 that came here. Before I go any further, some of you who come from the Nation of Islam, you always heard the Lamb say something to the effect, when Elijah speaks, hey, that black man, he had no birth records. That's why he said, you have no birth records. You were that old. You've been on this planet damn near 7 million years. All right? So, 3,000 people of Aden journeyed to Earth. They orbited about the Earth for many seasons as the planet was not yet ready for a man to live upon. And the other thing you would hear that the Lamb would say, the Grand Chief, Elijah Muhammad, Bay, Nobi, Grand Chief Robert J. Paul, Elijah Bay, that he always talked about the mothership. All right, so this is the mothership. So when the ancestors came here, they stood above the earth for a while, and you're about to hear the so-called war in heaven. which was actually only just took place on a spaceship. People got tired of traveling, and they were sitting on a spaceship. Now, I was never a Trekkie. You know, I said this before. I was never a Trekkie at all until I got initiated in the faith. I'm reading this, and I'm like, oh, all right, now I see where they get the ideas from Star Trek and whatever. So those of you who watch Star Trek and everything, you now see the idea and understand why Captain Kirk, when they all come, they say, you know, Star, come on with me. You know, Bones, beat me up, Scotty. You know, and they make sure they don't leave no great technology or something, you know what I mean? Because why? You can change the destiny of a primitive people. And then you come back, you're going to discover some stuff. Now you're going to pay your part in them blowing up themselves. So this is kind of, you know, giving you an idea of what happened here. I'm going to fill it in because it's in a higher piece of the Holy Corvette. The reason why our ancestors had to stay on the ship is because a lot of you so-called UFO people, when you get the backstory, like I said, I'm not taking, you know, for granted that you don't know. A lot of you do know some things that you heard the term. The earth is a prison. Now, figure something out. Now, at the time our ancestors got here, before then, we were all star travelers. So in our old civilizations and other civilizations on other planets, they didn't believe in the corporal punishment of taking someone's life if they did heinous crimes. What we did was we just exiled the dissidents. So we all from different galaxies dropped a lot of different prisoners here. And I have used the example, if any of y'all seen the movie of The One with Jet Li. So you see at the end where, you know, he wound up being, you know, because they were time traveling or space traveling to different dimensions. And the only way they can punish a person, what they did at the end of the movie, they put them on a planet where all the dissidents live on that planet. And of course, Jet Li's character was real powerful, so he was going to fight. I was looking at the sequel to that, but the point is, that's what happened. So by the time our ancestors got here, the criminals did the basic thing of evolution. You know what I mean? You leave the people alone, they evolve. And they wind up messing with the atomic energy, stuff like that. They darn near blew themselves up. So by the time we got here, it was barely a small pocket, barely 50 people that totally existed on the planet. And they wind up going back to being primitive. And the destruction was so bad, it had left a cloud on the planet and kind of destabilized it, but it just had to kind of level out. So this is where you're going to then hear from the Holy Corvette why Yohad. And this is Sword of Four. The chief of the human people was called Yohad. That's Y-O-H-O-D. Who was the Lemurian. He was like the captain of the ship. So, let me read this a bit. He selected Aban and Amalgam, who was very wise to go upon the face of the earth and prepare the way for the rest of the humans. So, like I said, going back to that Star Trek type of thing, you know, they explore and whatever. So what Aban was doing, that's your Adam. A-B-A-M, Aban. He was no more than like the scientist, kind of like the movie Matt Damon did with the Mars movie when he got left.
Martian.
Yeah, the Martian movie, yeah. And what did he have to do? Those who got there, they had to terraform the planet. Find what was what was, you know, edible, yada yada. Had he not been stuck there and the communication and all that was wrong, he would have stayed there and he would have continued, kept doing things, explore, and terraform the planet. You know, planting seeds to make food, of course, more trees, make more oxygen. Then you do other things with your compost to make your, you know what I mean? So these are other little forms of terraforming. Don't forget that term. So that was generally Oban's job. He was generally just on the planet and reporting back to the main ship by way of Yohad coming to visit him. The main people, our ancestors, was on the ship. They were getting tired. They traveled for so long. They wanted to get on. They wanted to put their feet on a planet. So his job was gathering data. Yohad would come and check on. Sura 5, this is where Yohad took a band to the earth, and from the great round sphere, that was the description of the ship that we had traveled. Oh, and what I understood, if I told you your mind power was powerful, the pyramid shape is an old shape. It is a very powerful shape. We actually use the pyramid power to propel our ship. Right, and it was something to the effect of a pyramid within another pyramid, what have you. So you're going to also discover, too, as I drop stuff on you, shapes do have an effect. It changes with the cosmic energy hitting. Try to endeavor more into that science and eventually bring that lesson. Yes, ma'am.
I didn't want to cut your wisdom, but in the newest of Indiana Jones movies, mm-hmm. they have the pyramid and they have like the ancient, I don't know what you call it, ancestors, but the pyramid was actually the spaceship. It looks mm-hmm. like a landing for it.
Matter of fact, that was in Stargate, too.
No,
the
Indiana Jones.
Yeah, the Indiana Jones. All right. Yeah, because it's, put it like this, what I was about to say, my beloved Sheriff has said, you'll find out in the Holy Quebec that different shapes, because remember, you're all being bombarded by cosmic forces already. The main energy radiation you're feeling is the sun. And you being master astrologers, you already know those subtle vibrations affect you too. You know, places, yada, 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 yada. Well, when you're in a certain shaped building or place and the cosmic forces are hitting you, it changes time. Whether accelerating, slowing it down, or just plain stopping. All right? So know that. So, yes.
Islam, the you know, when I stepped outside the building, I could see, I'm assuming it's the moon, or there's, right up here you can see a planet or something to the right of the building. And I see it all the time. And it's kind of quarter of the way, maybe half of it is, you can see the circumference that is round.
Yeah.
But to me, it just doesn't strike me as whatever it's supposed to be. I don't think it's the moon because it's some kind of planet. What is that?
That's very visible. I haven't really seen, unless anyone has been following me in Femeris.
You know?
Yeah, brother.
He's got his hand up over here.
It's Jupiter transiting Libra in the Vedic. All right, pairing transit, Scorpio retrograde.
So that's the planet, Jupiter, if you look out.
Yes, if you look about right here, I have a telescopic app, Night Sky, if anybody want to download it, or SkyMap for Android. If you look about right here, we got, going east, we got Ophiuchus here and just about here, and got Jupiter in Libra. And the moon is about to transit that as well. But yeah, I mean, that's Jupiter that she's seeing.
All right. And thank y'all so much. And this is where the astrology comes from. But I wanted to let you know about that because.
You have a hand over here.
Yes.
Wait a minute. Sorry, I have a question. So you said that different buildings have different effects.
Yeah, meaning basically different shapes. Because we all being bombarded by cosmic forces. So this being a certain shape, it's affecting us. Same thing if it's, I'm trying to recall, because like I said, I have so many lessons to bring on, whether it's Great White Brotherhood or Freemasonry or Magi work. But one of them actually accelerates aging. So,
to lead on to that, is that why most buildings are like rectangular?
Yeah, and I'm believing, a lot of time I had to look over my notes and stuff. Believing that is one of the shapes we kind of don't want to mess with.
Mm-hmm. That explains a lot.
Yeah, because again, you'll find out that being inside a pyramid and having another pyramid inside a pyramid, you damn near would just stop time, you stop aging. So I do remember that. I have a pyramid, of course, about the size of my hand, but I used to have a little crystal amethyst on it. Sometimes I put it in a pyramid on my television. Gave it to my baby cousin, and he probably her age.
because she wanted it, but it's where my crime. But know that that's where the importance of the what you call the pyramid shape is, how important it is. I remember as a little boy, I always thought it was, is this something you believe in? And they said, if you want to really test it, you know, you have a pyramid shape, get an old rusty, you know, razor blade that's not really sharp, and leave it up under it, and leave it there for a while, and then use it as sharp again. So remember what I just said. There will be a portion. I may have it here, but I don't feel like thumbing through it because I'm trying to get to the demonstration stuff that I want to give y'all. But there is a shape that where it will just stop time or accelerate or reverse. Make it younger. So I ain't never, matter of fact, since we keep talking about this, make your way to metaphysical shops and try to get your pyramid shape. It may seem weird, so I'm giving y'all to be on this subject. My own practice, like I said, I have one that is actually the size of my hand, the quartz one is tan. I actually have a white quartz one. Anyway, sometimes when I do my meditation, thank you. We're people. I ain't know about y'all, but I was just convinced to just do it in these numbers. I couldn't get a bill of coffee. Put the pill in the drink, in the drink, in the pill. That feels good. I feel like that. Anyway, I do my meditation whereas I place the pyramid on my head. I sometimes take maybe an hour or so when it opened. And it was one brother. I lost contact with his brother. He had somebody that actually made him a copper framed pyramid. It was just about as big, I'll say from here to here. And it was a copper frame, and it came up, and at the tip it had where he put his jewel. He would just sit right up under me. And I forgot how much he said was made it for, about 200 or something. And I forgot to get the number from him. But that'll be something kind of use. But at least know that. So you won't think that it's, you know, those people with them tin hat things, man, they are really they are, man. I just don't know. Yeah. Why do you think you got your fezzes on your head? It's terrible. Your fez is your little short version of your pyramid. You know what I'm saying? So, and we already know, some of you know, that usually the older fez is usually taller. And, so, but I think we did talk about that because then that's something that, you know, you'll see the difference. You'll see the difference if you do that. Same thing, you know, if you do the training, like I gave you earlier, the eye training, trust, you'll be happy. That hypnotic gaze training. It'll take a while. Because even though I was asking some individuals, like, no, I ain't did it. Like, it's a month, but once you complete it, it's a tool. You'll be like, all right, I'm glad I got it. Time to come in handy. Deal with certain people. Yes.
Once you get that hypnotic
gaze,
once
you do it, you're good. Like I said, you know, from that point on, you know what I mean? Walk up to vicious dog, and everybody else can be running, you be the one to go. He's sitting there, just staring just right at him. And he's gonna go, dog ain't gonna look at you. Dog ain't gonna look at you. Can't look in your eyes. Then now when you're dealing with a human, it's like, you know, I'm a Taurian, so you know, move by me, it's confident. So. But I get serious. I'm dealing with negative imps. The minions, guess what I do? Yeah, all right. And if you're feeling some change in your line and stuff, I'm going right at it. Yeah, all right. And this is where I said I want to make sure I teach you a pattern. You bring your voice down. You talk with intent. I always tell people, I say what I feel and I feel what I say. I have enough training to put power behind my words. Yes.
how you can trip somebody up when they're trying to find your mind. Get them to focus on something else. Like, say, suppose you tell them, hey, can you read this? And they're reading something. And then you ask, quickly ask the questions you really want. And usually when they're focusing on something, it's harder for them to lie. Especially when they're staring at the eye. Alright? You're working here, but we want to go through it. We might not go through it during this time. We're going to go off. So we're going to get I know. You're like, I know. I'm always standing here. Well, how about I do this?
Off camera.
I know. Alright, let me get back. So, like I said, the chief of the human people were Yohar, who was Lemurian, and he selected a band, Imogen, the very wise, to go upon the face of the earth and to prepare the way for the rest of the humans, because again, the ancestors were in the spaceship. Yohar took Obam to the earth from the great round sphere and served as a sky home for many seasons and explored the surface of the earth. Yohar told him all was safe to eat except a certain fungi which he ate and he might die. Now, I'm going to stop there real quick. This is where you get the story of Adam. He with the apple, with the big apple, but it wasn't an apple. It was actually a mushroom. You already know the Caribbean, truly indigenous people. And we know one of the high people think people get high off this mushroom, they call it pale or shrooms. And us, the Magi, or you call us the shamans, we even take a portion of that in certain rituals and we use that on a spiritual ritual, or you can say a spiritual journey, but you don't eat the whole thing. Or hot, like, yo, I met God. I don't feel no, take enough. And you would also have a shaman there that would guide you through it. And you see a lot of it depicted in movies when they depict us Native Americans. Matter of fact, it was one of the young guns with Lou Diamond in his little journey. It's an old movie, and your young babies are like, young who? Who is that? That's on Betamax? What is that? And, but yeah, all it was a mushroom. After Obam had lived upon the face of the earth for some time, he became lonely and called upon Yohad, who was the captain, to send him a woman. Yohad sent him Ova, O-V-A, another Amalgam to stay with him. Now, she ain't just a regular woman. She was a scientist like him, so they were gathering information to prepare to see what was edible, where we could live, yada, yada. So again, this is where the Bible told the story, but they changed it up. Because a lot of you know you being here. Oh.
Well, I had a question. When you were mentioning the mushroom, have you ever heard of ayahuasca? It's something that...
Ayahuasca.
Yes. Ayahuasca. It's something that... and so this is like super quick story. Some of the so-called Native Americans, I'm not sure who they are, I haven't met them yet.
Shemites.
Okay.
You the real one. They Shemites. It's on the reservation. Go ahead.
Yeah. So they have certain rituals that they'll do, and they're saying that they'll have this plant, and it's supposed to allow you your pineal gland to be activated, and so you'll be able to become more susceptible to things, and you're supposed to meet your like animal spirit guides.
Totem and stuff like that, right?
Yeah. So, do you think that's something that is okay to like explore or practice?
Put it like this: our Magi priesthood is just so much I have to give y'all. We are broken down into many different. I don't want to say fractions, but people that focus on certain things in your older priesthood. So you know you're here in St. Louis, it's you. Right now, you're where you left when you fell off, where you fell. Probably said in order for you to get back up, you had to get back where you fell. You're a monster. Then, but prior to that, you were known as the Magi, you were a priest. You're the one who told the world Jesus was coming. Alright. We have some that focus on healing of hands, there are actual lessons that go into herbs. So I don't specialize in it. That's the second part of the Holy Corvette that, like I said, is usually given to initiates. And we actually have the cure for pediatric cancer. And if I got it right here, I'd probably turn to the page and tell you. And this is old. You know, we just actually go into it, you know. But, you know, so, but there's a technical aspect of it, whereas we have certain herbs that is mixed for, like I just said earlier, what you're saying, you're saying it another way, that, you know, you would have a shaman. Shaman could have been a woman too. Remember, we're coming out of the patriarchal aspect, even though somebody can push you more, the matriarch, all that is pushing. Right now, we're coming back to the pavement, the balance. You already studied history, you already know we did the matriarchal thing. And it didn't work. And our ancestors just went to the opposite extreme patriarchal. Now we're coming out of it. We're in a photon belt energy, whereas now you got to get back to the balance. Man and woman is equal, but the woman does have slight more power than man, but she gives life. But that's the only thing you must understand this paper. So, anyway, like I'm saying, there are some Hittians that master the herbs that, you know, will heal. There's a portion in the Holy Corvette where your ancestors from Mu, we were world renowned before Mu sang. And people will come, that actually pieces of that is in the scripture, where people come from all over just to be healed by you moves, because you healed everybody. You are such a beautiful, happy people. If I had a mark that, I would read that part in the Holy Corvette, but it would tell you, you were experts in herbs. Then there's a portion in our priesthood where you have some that just heal with the hands, or they heal with colors and lights. So when you see the different pyramids, they were actually schools of learning or places to be healed. And of course, you Moors already know the oldest pyramids is on this planet is here. So, me reading this part here from the Holy Corvette, I have to say for you new brothers and sisters, this was the landmass you first touched down on. So, when we're talking here, you call this Amalia. And then later on, you got named Mexico. But this is where you touched down. And this is why you have the first pyramids. That's the oldest pyramids on the planet. And I just told you earlier, I said it was your pyramid power that propelled your ships to get you here. And your ancestors sat on the pyramid knowledge for, you know, like a little eon before they started using it. And it was the Yuliak whom they erroneously would call the Mayans and all that started the pyramid. They started building. So, but yeah, we're broken in different priesthoods. And like I said, you know, the second part, we actually have the cure. We actually have a cure for cancer, cure for other stuff. Like, for instance, the Creator said, if you ever get stung by a plant, for one, whatever there's a poisonous plant and you need a cure, the Creator said, I've created it not too far from that particular plant. But if the plant stings with me, then you dig underground, you get its roots, and you put it on the womb. Same thing if it says if a bug or whatever bites the, you crush it and put it on the womb. Same thing with it right now, I'm going to look at it, where it said a venomous snake, the powder of an acorn made of tea resists poisons of venomous creatures. Crush the acorn bark and oak as an antidote against poisonous medicines. These are just some of the things, like I said, you know, those on the left-hand path, if they really get this work, it could be used to the negative. So, but yeah, we specialize in a lot of different signs, and it was just all up under the one priesthood, or your own creed, the faith, that the Ashkenazis renamed and called it the Jewish faith, the Jewish Star, and it's not, or they call it the Star of Dawood or David. And even we used to have King Dawood here, he would tell you, the star was older than him. I'm telling you, it's the symbol that represented you. You were called Hittians, meaning knowledgeable people of God. But the people outside the faith, they called us the Magi, or King Priest, or Queen Priest. And when you functioned under that creed, the sisters was equal with the brothers. And As I told you earlier, I said the Freemasonry is based off of our priesthood. Same thing, the whole Catholic priesthood is based off of. We have three tiers. We have the highest, which is the grand priesthood. Then we have the middle, which is the high priesthood. I don't feel like writing everything out. So anyway. And then we have the low priesthood. Well, as the Catholics, which are feeding you Moors, they can only translate for so much. Because our sacred writings and Lemurian writings, that's the oldest writing, that's the writing that came from. The Christians were only able to, at least get the beginning part of our high priesthood, they was only able to translate that and structure the Catholic priesthood. That's why their ranking only goes as high as the archbishop. But it's a higher rank. And then when you get to the beginning rank of the level that I am in the grand priesthood, the first rank of that is called a mystic. And I also instructed some of you to look at the history or the creed or religion of Zarathustra. We call him Zarathustra. Zarathustra was a part of our faith. He was actually two grades below me, two ranks below me. I'm a patriarch, but I just used the informal title, Father. I'm going to use patriarch. I'm going to use the informal. But anyway, under me is the first rank is mystic. The next rank is the grand mystic. And then the level that I am, for me, is a matriarch, who is a sister, who is a patriarch, who both equal, being mother, the tribe, the father, the tribe. Well, anyway, he was a keeper of our sacred object of our faith. And he wanted to take this gospel back to the people. So, Zarathustra. So, what he did, he went and searched for someone that was worthy to, I can't tell you the object, but anyway, it's a sacred object. It's the sacred object is so potent and powerful, just holding it, you can be healed by it. But anyway, he found a worthy magi to take his place, and then the rest is history. He went back to his people, and that's when the Zoroastrian faith was founded. But he was one of you. Now I say this, if any of you who already did research and you see how those people dress, I'm going to direct you all to the right, to the flag and the brother in the portrait over there. Now you tell me, do those clothes look like a Muslim or do they look like someone from the Zoroastrian faith? For those on the camera, you're looking at the picture of Noble Drew Ali. So I'm only just touching on what Brother Prophet said, the half hasn't been told. If I tell you everything, you go back to sleep. And when you do come across the Zoroastrian faith, the first thing it will say, pre-Islam. And a lot of the faiths always give respect and say, for such an old faith, an ancient faith, they sure was well organized and them believing in a monotheistic religion, meaning they believe in one God. Now they call God Ahura Mazda. Us Indians, we call the Creator by the name that the Creator called itself. Our ancestors had enough sense to ask the Creator, they said, all right, well, we call you by many names, you know, what's your name? And the Creator said, yeah, I recognize that you call me by many names, so I'm letting you know now. The Creator said, it's all good. But because you asked me, my name is Haredi. It only means the thought. So those who I communicate, when I communicate with you, I may say, you know, praise the Creator, Haredi, Allah, Ahura Mazda. And it shouldn't sound foreign to any of you who are in the temple. You have the nationality card. What does it say? You know, you give honor to Ali, Muhammad, Buddha, Jesus, etc. It used to say Confucius, but it says etc. So what Drew Ali is telling you? Trembling what I'm saying to you. All faiths come from you. I'm just taking you back to your ancient. So, but let me finish this and we're going to get into back onto the mind and we're going to do the demo. I would ask for those who are the new ones here, if y'all can take a moment, because you know how we all climb out, we talk, we eat some chips, and you know, stuff. If y'all can give them the training, stuff, or I know someone probably comes to me anyway, for the hypnotic gaze. And I endeavor to help him possibly before the mid-summer. Try to do the training, because this is part of your work. And it's one of the secrets, like I told y'all, it's very, very important tool that can be used. Right? It might even mean your life. And it will open the doorway to other talents. Right? You may have heard me, sometimes I'll teach you with vignettes and everything, but haven't you heard the story of one brother who gave Brother Prophet hard time? And this brother was negative, so other Moors heard about it. And they were going to move on. They were going to do a rose in the mist. They were going to hurt. They were going to hurt him on. So, Prophet knowing this, the Prophet had the ability, that's why I tell you to see the shadow, and then also see Darren Brown. And I'll tell you also, look up Wolf Messick. These are real people in history. Because when you tell something about the Prophet, people don't kind of believe it. They're like, well, that's the Jesus thing. Jesus thing, you know, that ain't really real. So I want you to see Wolf Messick. Wolf Messick was a gentleman who had the ability, kind of like the Charles Xavier type of thing. He actually proved through Stalin that he actually robbed the bank just using a piece of paper, and he walked out with money, whatever. So I want you to see that. So now get back to the Prophet in the sky. So this particular Moor wanted to give the Prophet a hard time. And the Moors didn't like it, they were going to move on. So what the Prophet did is use his ability and clouded the minds of those other Moors and made him seem old. So what happened, now this was in another city. So the Prophet was one place, this guy was in another city. He was supposed to be coming out of the temple. And the brothers knew he was going to come. They were going to move on. And the brother was locking it up and whatever. And he's about to walk, and two guys are walking. And he knows they walk by. He walked by. They walked by. Well, later on, the man found out what the Prophet did. He clouded their mind and made him seem like an old man to them. So they didn't recognize him. So they walked by. So me telling you this, I want you to put this in the prophet's, in the Jesus level of the water thing, and press it, taste it. So I want you to actually understand what I'm trying to tell you. These things, these tools I'm giving you, is the foundation. You know what I mean? It's the foundation. Like, again, you look up Wolf Messick. Dude, here's one of the experiments he did. I'm going to move on after this so you can understand. And he didn't reenact. This stuff is documented. Wolf Messick was an Ashkenazi Jew. And he had an ability. His actual day job, he was a mentalist. He did all the bad stuff, whatever, whatever. He was real deep. He's a humble man, too. So he predicted the war, and when Hitler was going to die, Hitler got pissed off. Hitler put the money on his head. He had to leave, and he had to go to Russia. So he went to Russia, and Stalin was like, you know, he's another citizen. I'm like, I don't know if he's going to be, you know what I mean, a agent, a double agent. But I have heard of you, Wolf Messing. So then he said, I want to test you. So anybody who's in the military, you know, you just can't walk on a military base. So we'll say it's like a mile away from the main gate coming on the base. And Stalin's house, his quarters, was in the middle of the base. So he said, for one of his tests was, he said, all right, I want you to use your ability to get back on the base. Now, again, it's no different than like if you try to go to the White House. You can't get behind up there and try to see like you want to walk up in the White House. You won't get stopped. So it's the same thing you do on a military bus or on a military base. So they actually walked this man, Grayson, walked them all out to the gate. And a short time later, this man, Grayson, walked by the first checkpoint. These are soldiers now. They're standing in the bar with guns. and it's about a mile walk. Now he gets to the house quarters. And Stalin, if you know history, he was like the head general guy. You know, they all know protectors, my point. So he's walking by two other guards that's outside the house. Now he's inside, he's walking past other guards. Now he's walking past the butlers and the maids. And the butlers and the maids were ex-KGB. Before he knew it, he walked up on Stalin, sitting in his chair, and he scared the bees out. He said, oh, wow. I said, Dad, all right, how did you do that? How did you get it? Because you just don't, the civilian just can't walk on base. And he said this. He said, what he did was, he projected in the minds of the soldiers that he was burying. Beria was the highest military guy in the Russian military. So now, since you're the new generation, you see the X-Men movies and stuff, you've seen Charles Xavier or Emma Frost. So in their minds, he was in military form and looking like someone else, which was Beria. So if he's the highest official, of course some soldiers of lower ranks, they won't move. That's why he was able to walk right by. All he did was project his thoughts in their thoughts. No discourse. You are the sum total of your inner thoughts. 98% of what you do is from your subconscious. I say it again. You are the sum total of your thoughts. Love your Heavenly Father. They say you are as beautiful as your thoughts. Are you not? Right on.
Yes.
You're as beautiful as your parents. Know that. I'm looking at right now my extended brothers and sisters. Beautiful little baby cherubs. Know that. So you can change yourself, like Dr. Nala Hill had added, you want to be or you don't want to be, you are. So when you change your affirmations to correct yourself, to change that, you want to say, I am, I am. To finish this, because I'm going to now get into that, we want to do a demo. I'm going to teach y'all the light state, hypnosis, how to induce, because I've been dropping stuff here and there, but I want to get into it so that you can basically. This. All right. Now, Sword 5 says that Yohai took a band to Earth and from the great sphere, right, said that, and there was many more, many senses. And then I said Sword 6 was after a band had lived upon the face of Earth for some time, he became lonely and called upon Yohai to send him a woman, which was over. Now, Sword 7 is this. The Band of Over stayed upon the face of the earth for many seasons, preparing for the others to live upon the earth. Sora 8, this is the war in heaven. Luxor, the second in command of the ship, told Yohai they did not wish to remain in the starship any longer and wanted to go to earth to live. Yohai told him the time was not yet right. Sword 9, Luxor gathered as many as he would follow him and rose up against Yohai and his people while they slept. So now you're talking about the insurrection, or we call it a mutiny in the ship. This is the war in heaven. Luxor is your Lucifer. Yohai awoke, and there was a great battle in which Yohai overcame the enemy. Yohai placed Luxor and his followers in a small skyship that looked like a large serpent and sent them into outer darkness. Luxor turned the ship around towards the earth with the help of his followers and landed upon the earth near where Abam and Over were living. This is Sword 11. One day, as Orwell was alone gathering fruit, Luxor approached her and told her that Yochai had sent him there to watch over her and her band. And he told her also that if she ate the fungi that Yochai told him not to eat, that she wouldn't die, but would be enlightened. Remember I said, you know, it depends on an expert using the peyote or the mushroom and mix it in a certain way. You can use it in a ritual where it opens you up to enlightenment. A good reference, visual reference, there was a beautiful movie done about Nostradamus in the late 90s. HBO, so if you can, IDB, look it up, Nostradamus, and it was a great depiction. But it's a scene in the movie where Nostradamus met with another doctor he was studying to get his doctoral degree. And his doctor was a part of one of the sacred orders. The Rosicrucians and Freemasons, again, like I told y'all, came out of your heart, your priesthood, and I'm telling you, magic. So it was a sacred area in his room, and he had all Moorish books that the Christians was burning. And he said to, you know, Nostradamus, you know, these are the books such and such, you only read them here, in secret. And then he had a little bowl, and he said, you only take a little dab of it, and what have you. And he basically was telling him it would help him open his psychic mind. And in the film, he kind of named two of the ingredients. He said, no cinnamon, nothing. All right? So I kind of want you to see it. But it was a great depiction of Nostradamus. Because it shows you, you know, he was healing people while everybody was dying the Black Death. You Moors knew. The reason why you weren't dying of it, because part of your Moorish culture was you bathed. You washed your... Christians, part of their religion was they didn't bathe. That was the European custom. Don't say that I said it. Do your research and you'll see. And so this is why they were dying from the Black Plague. And saying, we don't know. I remember I had Western students in college. And they're like, we just don't know. We're dying. Of course you weren't dying. You weren't bathing. Yeah.
Atomic tea in school is that they said they died because they kept helping, like the family members and stuff like that. Because one person is, and the next person,
yeah,
that helped them.
I'm gonna tell you straight up.
Confused, right?
I'm gonna tell you straight up. Hollywood, they were dirty. They were riding dirty. No, for real. Look, you know how it is when we need trash too much in our house, in our apartment. That's just us leaving and be like, ooh, hey, you know, I won't bring it, they don't care, baby. That smell, damn, I ain't getting, you know, you gotta take it out. It stink. That's just leaving it in a day too long. Well, guess what they did? Went to the window, dump it out in front of the house. Do your research. On top of that, they didn't wash. Yes.
Something also that I put on my page recently, they would mix urine with water to wash their clothes. They wash their clothes in urine.
The decades, I thought I had it. You got that. That's a mic drop right there.
Yeah.
I ain't never heard of that.
I just put it on my page maybe a week or so ago because I was doing some research and it said that they, like,
I'll make sure I shake it off. I don't want my own stuff on me. Ew. You got that. Put it in the water, wash my clothes. I don't even want my breath. And everybody, look, we all know we wake up, I got breath. You know, what?
Yeah, they would mix the water, I mean urine with some water, and they would wash their clothes in urine.
And wonder why flies walk around. Look. I had to learn this to just benefit me dating older women, because us guys, we don't know. We grow up, we got one washcloth. Yeah. Like, women be like, honey. Then there's another one with this looking baby. So, of course, you know, sometimes those guys find the hard way. Like, yeah, baby, what? Yeah, all right, yeah. That's just kind of clean yourself. You beat me on that. Ah, boy, decade, because Dr. Jose Pimenta based it in the 90s. He said it was a book by Terry McLaughlin, I still remember the title, called Dirt. And it was many ways of how to use it, and I think it even ate. He said it's a book you don't read when you're going to eat. You beat me on that one. I ain't lying. You know how I joke sometimes they might drop that urine. I can't stand flies.
Maybe I got
another one
for you.
That guy, when I pass.
For real? If you think that was something, somebody sent me a video of a woman, and I kind of sent it to some people. A woman was standing on the outside, a European, and she said that a lot of people are asking me why my skin is so clear and beautiful like this and what it is I do. Mm-hmm. And she has a dog on a leash, and she has a clear cup in her hand. She said, this is what I do. You know, the dog raised his leg at the tree, she caught the unicorn. And then she drank it. She drank it. I probably said it to some of y'all. And she said this is how she keeps her skin clean.
I see that.
Did you see that?
I would see it, I'd be like, what happened to you? The dog is the worst.
All right, now, come on.
Y'all got me on that. I just told some guy the other day, he's like, yeah, man, I eat horse meat. And I said, you don't want to eat horse. You know, they was changing people's meat back in the time of the president. And you was eating horse meat, they didn't know about. But the reason why is, see what plays the horse. It's a worm called a horsehair worm. And the way you see it infects other insects and control it. And when it dies, it comes right out of it. And you're like, this little small insect also has this worm. It's about as long as this. It's a horse hair. And they come from horses. And it's a certain worm that the horses get that once they got it, they just die. They just, you know, like, you beat me on that. I thought I was explicit. Woo, all righty. What happened? You got me on that one. You know, well, let's kill a mood on that. Let's move on something. Ooh, we got to shake this off. I don't want to go into demo stuff that I was saying. Yeah. I get pissed with somebody. Oh, you get a baby and they doing that by accident and get pissed on. All right. Well, we going to move this on. Remember I said I wanted to now do the demo, I want to teach y'all the general thing of hypnosis. If y'all can, I want to, for those who've had this before, we want to cover, there's 5 laws, brother. I want to cover for you young and brothers have been here. There's 5 basic, well, actually 6 or 7 laws of what they call hypnosis or suggestibility that you need to be aware of. And I want y'all to help me out because we want to move forward. And those 5 or 7 laws are actually being used every day. One of them is the reverse reaction, meaning when somebody is saying, you know, reverse psychology, meaning a strong suggestion and a weak suggestion in the same suggestion, or is a passive suggestion with a misdirection and command. You know, try to confuse. That's the key in hypnosis, confuse. Again, that's basically, we offer reverse psychology, so that's all reverse action is. The second one is all repetition. That means a suggestion is just repeated over and over. This is where you get with your commercials on TV. Now we're in a higher high-tech internet stuff, so now we got our phones or our laptops, but prior to that was your radio and your TV and what have you, and you have your billboard ads, all right? And you remember, I said to some of you, I said, you're dark wizards of this art of suggestion, using suggestion as your advertising agencies. And they utilize these laws to get you to buy things you do not need. Also know that colors are also a part of effect. So if you don't know, blue is more tranquil. Red is more of a aggressive or awake state. That's why I use it. Also, sometimes they'll say, when you're more, you go to court, kind of red, all red. But I also told, like I told other wards, find a seamstress and try to have your worst robe made. Some elders will sit back to their court robe. Remember the prophet said, if you take out a prophet, you can't go wrong. Right? And you're doing business. All right, the third one is the role of dominance. This is a suggestion that's given in an authoritative way. You know, like a paternal way, you might hear the term sleep, whatever other suggestion. We don't do different suggestions. So. The fourth one is delayed reaction. So this is when the suggestion is given and the person reacts a little later from the suggestion that you have given. The next one is kind of associated with delayed action. It's called the law of association. So all it is again, a suggestion is given and it's activated later on, maybe by a stimulus from the other person. When you see Taj and you see him with the blue shirt on, and you're about to ask him a question, the person is probably always nervous. So when he's in his presence, you see the blue shirt on, now all of a sudden he gets the confidence. That's the stimulus for his delayed action, and he then carries out that suggestion. The sixth one was the law of will and imagination. I always give the example of when I say, like, a person will walk a plank, it's on the ground, and, you know what I mean, you tell them to walk and you have a problem, you say, hey, skip and jump, you know, and it could be as wide as this, and it could be very long. The person will, hey, now I take the same plank and put it up on a 22-story building from roof to roof, secure it very well. It won't move. We even test the wind, make sure no wind, and then we tell that same person, now walk across and see what they'll do. They'll be hesitant, and they might not just walk. Now here's where the sixth law kicks in. I just told you it's called will and imagination. I'm laying down for it right on the board, but what it is this, and this is the law that magicians rely on when you come into performing, and also you, knowing the signs, because you're dealing with this anyway. Will and imagination. See, when you get the will to be in conflict with imagination will always win out. So here's why the person won't walk the plank. It's 20 stories above. It's because their will is, well, I just walked it on the ground. Hell, I was skipping, doing a moonwalk, whatever, crip walk, everything, you know, and hey, didn't know, but then now it's the same thing, but it's secure. In your mind now, you're imagining I'm up high, what if I, now I'm going to fall. So the imagination of internally, so this is an internal battle, of you possibly falling, the imagination is now winning out your will, which then creates the great fear, which causes you not to step on the board or walk across. That's just an example, but there's many ways you can use these laws. And then the other one, which we have the last, and always have people participate, which is the law of hypnotic rhythm. Now I ask someone from the crowd if you can give the basic understanding of that. Some of my old students. Law of compensation. Go ahead.
Mike? I wanted to say something about
you
said you suggested Danley Hall being operating the devil for.
Yeah. If you heard him, he said it was, you know, I suggested the video or listening to Outwitting the Devil. The law of hypnotic rhythm means that you just keep focusing on something subconsciously and you get caught into a rut. It's just a matter of you changing your inner thoughts. Or the old saying, your focus determines your reality. Remember, I just said to you, you are the sum total of your inner thoughts. rest of the day. And also know this, 11 months from now, all the cells in your body will be a whole new cell. So now, since you know the mind is beautiful and you can change, this is where you can sculpt yourself the way you want, whether it's mental or physical. That's the secret. That's what you're determining your presence when you made here. You are truly the master or the sister, master of Solomon's temple. Right? So now, me getting through that, I'm going to need somebody to demonstrate. I want everyone to follow. Here's another point, too. What I said, how do you influence people? Because here's the key thing. How many times I said to you, Morris, that you have to get a person to cooperate or do something in order to get them into a suggestible state? People whispering, you got to talk in the mic or scream or shout. The people out there, you can't read sign language.
Five times.
Yeah, but why are you asking the question?
Five times.
Yeah. I was just saying, I can read sign language. So, all right. So, again, giving you another example, car salesmen. There are classes that they take to make them the best salesman. And these classes that I'm telling you, how to get a customer to do what you want them to do. So what you don't know is, when they come up and say, hey, how you doing? Say, you want to buy a car, you know. You want to buy a car, you're looking at the car, right? So then I ask him loaded questions. Boy, it's nice and hot out here today. And you got the money. And he said, oh, boy, it's hot out here. You
agree. Right?
Yes. And then I said, well, all right. So you're looking, you know, something sporty or casual, you know, or classic what?
Another green.
So I'm going to ask him another question. He jumped a little bit. I'm going to ask another question, which he's going to say yes. The key thing is you want the person to say yes. So you're asking loaded questions. Either would be dumb to say, boy, is that a green shirt or is that blue? And it's green, right? He's going to have to say yes. The key thing is you want to do it five times. This makes the person highly suggestible. All right? It can be the simplest little things. You might want to move the camera. It can be the simplest little things. You're like, hey, how are you doing? Yeah, can you do that for me? Can you hand me that? And the person?
Yes.
All right. And you hand it. So even if they're not saying yes, or they're doing it, they're complying. Get it? The key thing is you want it session five. They are key places that you will touch a person also. We're going to have a person demonstrate and we all want to take turns. Now, again, this is where your ingenuity, your creativity come in, where think ahead of time. Five questions I want to ask, and they got to say yes. Before I go any further, so now I'm making you aware, so when you go to places and you know somebody's trying to influence you, you know, Brother Priest, if you to it, and if you like me, I'm a jovial person, but sometimes me being a charming, I don't want to be bothered. Hey, can I help you? I'm good. And even if they try to talk, you think nonsense. Mental. Because you're not paying attention to them. You understand what I'm saying? So if they're talking to you, they continue to talk to you, you don't want to be bothered, you think nonsense in your mind. Or you could use the chant I gave y'all using the word E and just draw it out. It's messing with you. Remember I told you I gave you the brain wave to alpha, beta, da da da. Alright, so when you're saying E, even under your breath or eternally, it messes with the frequency and you won't pay attention to the person and it's less likely they will influence it. So the key thing is, when y'all walk out this door and I give you the secrets, you now know you're being influenced. And you don't feel like being bothered, you know now what to do to counter it. It ain't nonsense. I try to call things like this. Yes.
By the same token, we could use that if we want to get a yes from someone or a right. positive response.
Right. So now, Sheriff Eric Hood, hey, brother, you want to step up, man? We're going to show you the five key places that also influence individuals. Turn this way. And trust, remember I keep telling you, I'm just condensing it, and Dr. Nile and I are going to make sure y'all get the literature, condensing it to the point that you will have literature to go right through it. Try to test it, work this stuff in the street, done it. So I tell you, I work with Darren Brown and other key people. Other videos will come up and you'll see it. Everybody else is working on science, it's your science. You need to take it back. Like that old Peach Street commercial.
I want it now.
Here's one key area that you can influence the person. The forehead. Touching the forehead. Or the shoulder. Or the forearm or the hand. Alright? Those are just basic areas you can touch a person. So when you're in conversation with someone, why? Let me give you an example so you know where I'm coming from. Why do you think you see the power of in these suits, for your suits, magnets, and suits and stuff? He's coming in and the big guy, like, yes. Yes, you know. We need to go and do this, you know what I'm saying? Touch the person on the shoulder. Now here's the key. Here's another aspect of the science they call NLP. Us guys, so this would be a trick for girls to go with us guys trying to influence you. Us Romeo type guys use this to try to get a girl to follow us for the night. This appears to trick. We're in conversation with you, and then we get you and we'll say, recall the time you were happy with your boyfriend. You know, just recall that she'll, and when she does it, touch her shoulder. Good. Right. You might say something else, talk about something. And so, recall the time you were just very happy. It was a beautiful day, and it was just pleasant. And the same thing. Yeah. And then you do it one more time, you say something else, and then think about it. Now, what I am doing, it's called anchoring. It's called anchoring. So this is what's happening. When she, or even you doing a guy, but just an example saying, you know, I shouldn't be telling you guys, but at least you sisters know, I'll let you know.
I already know that.
See, all right, well, what you're doing, what we're doing is we're associating ourselves with your thoughts of your old boyfriend when you're in love. And then the next question, touching you, we're associating ourselves, we're tacking ourselves onto their inner imagination. So by the time they do the third time, we left her feeling good, and then we're like, oh yeah, let's give something from the other party, you know, we're here, yada yada. And so, you know, subconsciously, she's following him. Not knowing he did a sly black ops hypnotic thing of associating himself with her happy most. Now in our mind, internally, next to her boyfriend that she had a good time. Well, it was a bad breakup and he took her to the point where she was happy. It's the same thing you can kind of use when you're dealing with someone that is negative. You get them to think of something happy. Especially during the times when it's not a bad time. And then you can do a trigger. My trigger is, I may sing slightly under the breath, Michael Jackson's. And you just say it lightly, but they hear it. And a little later on, they're happy again, made them happy again, and you see, that's your little subliminal trick. So now when you're in a tough situation, it's a negative situation, you can quickly change that person's emotions unbeknownst to them. And they hear it, and all of a sudden, internally, remember I told you all the vacillation, change their emotion. And that could go either way with a man or woman. Please take these notes, or maybe record it, take it, utilize it. All right, now, here's some of another way of influencing a person. You say, brother, can you stand right here? Yeah, stand right here and face the board. And your hands are inside, and you go straight up. Now, everything he doesn't follow right now, he is more receptive. So then I can say, brother, I'm not putting you into a hypnotic state. I'm just putting you in a synchronistic state. Just relax. Just relax. Just breathe normally. Now, we can take them under. I'm just giving you tools of awake state. All right? Meaning, you don't deal with somebody in every day thing. You can still slide people in. Here's another point or two. When you daydream, anybody that's aware of the science, they know that's the right time to come right up to you and slide a suggestion and say, you are highly suggestible. And you go, huh? Now, to you, you might not know what that means. Highly suggestible, meaning then I can give you a suggestion and you will react, meaning then I can say, you're right for this stuff. Because when you were in your daydreaming state, your critical mind, remember I said the barrier, remember I said it's your conscious mind, and I said this is your subconscious mind, right? And I said it's your between, which is your barrier, that's your critical mind, that's the filter. When you daydream, you let your guard or your door, meaning a suggestion easily slides in, right? And any reactions that they do when it's grabbed by the subconscious mind, it's your nervous system, or the person's nervous system, that does the reaction. All right. Here's another understanding. Like, if you happen to view a hypnotic show, what will seem amazing to you, whereas, you know, of course they say, you know, go to sleep and they do all this, they have little funny things and whatever, and the show's about to end, and he says, all right, now you can go back to your seat. Now he's not telling them to go under, and they say, but before you do, your right foot is stuck. Person's foot is stuck. And he said, but when it's stuck, now you take your left hand, you hold your ear, you hold that, now it's loose, but then your hand's stuck. When you are at that state there, you're hyper-suggestible. The person doesn't have to say anything else, but just give you the suggestion. Your body will already react. So again, I'm going to explain it to you again. I'm giving you secrets. Your magicians make thousands and thousands, probably.
Yes, that I'm telling you.
They're hyper-suggestible. You're already hyper-suggestible already. I also refer to y'all to see the movie They Live. You're already being bombarded by suggestions already. Those who are white collar, when we all work at the job, and I was telling you, I know this in 2000 years, you go to the job, they have a daggone eagle on the wall that says perseverance. Or they have a person that's holding a pencil, determination. And then the other one will be somebody hanging on off the cliff. Hanging on. Well, that company went and talked to a firm that is in mass hypnosis, and those portraits are suggestions. And remember, the 90s was the key when they started giving you multitasking, the term multitasking. Well, if you continue to do different things, you can't focus. And then so what it is they say, all right, they say, Gene, I want you to go ahead and file these papers away. Oh, why are you at it? Go over there and help with saying, move the box over there, and they get you these three or four different things. And then really what they wanted to ask you, by then you're open suggestible. Then they come in and ask you what they really wanted you to do, by then you're open. That's why they had you multitasking. Because you're not focused. You're open to suggestion. So the real key thing is what I'm telling you, to now take focus, take your mind back, focus more. The moors, you see them pheasants and turbans. Meaning you're a master of your mind. The key thing also to influence the people is to cause confusion.
historic demonstration you did the other week. Remember the ball? So I want you to take the right hand, hold your right hand out, and there's a white cord, straight out, and there's a white cord with a big red balloon upon it. And it's full of healing. It's really big. And in the left hand palm, it's a big black bowling ball. Close your eyes. Now, the key thing is to focus on my voice. I'm going to demonstrate this. I want to have a couple of you come up and do the same. The key thing in hypnosis is to focus. Capture the person's attention. And then the person must also pay close attention. Know this. Don't never fall for that old, oh, I can't be hypnotized. Let me tell you who can't be hypnotized. Majority of people, young children. I know that was completely incorrect. And to challenge people and show them why, because they can't focus. But you can also hypnotize children. So know this, a person has to have intelligence in order to be influenced. And you're all influenced anyway. The more intelligent you are, the more you can be successful. So now, in your right arm, this red balloon is actually full of helium. And it's causing your right hand to go up, 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 up. And it's feeling really lighter. It starts to just go up, up, up. Now here, in your left hand, you got a 25-pound black bowling ball. And of course you can hold it because you're strong, you're strapping, bro. But after a while, as time goes on, this left hand is feeling tired. The ball starts to go down, 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 heavier. And the more that it's getting heavier, the right arm is feeling lighter, going up, up, it's feeling more lighter. Focus on my voice, the heavier the left ball is going. Heavier and heavier. Why the red balloon is causing the hand to go up, up, it's feeling lighter and lighter and lighter and lighter. Stop, open your eyes. Our part is, so I'm just giving you a basic example causing an internal confusion. Did you follow? Everybody follow? Everybody follow?
Follow.
Now, I'm asking anyone who will come up. You do the same. I want you to do it. I said, I'm keeping my word. I'm giving you your signs and mail. I'm asking you to come up.
I use that science. I am bad girl.
can keep things, they keep switching up, they keep focusing this mind. That's the key thing, to keep the people focused. And I'm just giving you the template. And before I know it, y'all come back and say, hey, I got another way I do this. I did this and yada yada. I would love to hear your stories. I'm giving you the template. So again, you're seeing the bowling ball, you give it a certain weight. You know he's a strong brother, so yeah, he can hold it 25, but wow, it's gonna be heavy. The key thing is you want to keep describing, it's heavier and heavier and heavier. Put your hands down now, so you want to do the exact thing. You can construct a little bit of it on that. Because again, the key thing is to talk with authority. Alright? You already know that now. You built your ills and bangs, your wars. There's nothing to trip about. It's your principality. Just use it.
Where's the other mic?
So you want him
here.
Close his eyes, take away his stimulus. Alright?
When he closes his eyes, take away his stimulus. Then you're telling him to put his arms up. Right?
Close your eyes. Put both your hands in front of you. One hand is up and one hand is down. You feel relaxed, you feel comfortable. So in your right hand, you have a white string with a large balloon full of helium. It's pulling your hand upwards and it's making your hand feel light. And in your other hand, you have a bowling ball that's 30 pounds and it's making your hand feel heavy. And it's pulling your hand lower and lower. The hand with the red balloon full of helium is getting lighter and it's allowing your hand to go more upward, higher and higher. The bowling ball is getting heavier and you're allowing the weight to bring your hand lower and lower. Wake up.
Idea of the seven liberal arts, and it says study rhetoric, meaning this is when you then go into the dictionary, which a lot of you are doing already with etymology. So now you start to study more adjectives. So if you're talking about heavier, more tiring, here's other key words you can use. And when I say the cloud of mind, you can say dim or foggy. Alright, so I'm going to give you some other power words. Now he's going to do this, and I want someone else, before I go any further, because I want to try to keep this on the roll. I want all y'all to have confidence and experience this. I really would love to do this. Alright? Be the next to come up. And it would be someone else. I mean, I can get like two more people, but I want y'all to be down. I want y'all to be shy, because again, I'm giving you what you call added knowledge. You don't want it. Hey, I can pack my stuff here and probably go, hey, this is my ride. Oh, Friday night too? Yeah. Let me know. Let me know. I can leave now. Do my comedy video. But I want to give to y'all because you all came out to see the knowledge and stuff that we're giving you. I'm giving you sacred knowledge. I'm giving you heavy stuff. This is a tool. This is a tool that can be used. I'm giving you the blueprint. As y'all come, a lot of this is in print, so we're in the point of printing things up, so you'll be getting this in print, all right? Just condensing it, but I want you to get the practicality. Now, obviously, you know, you get a new job, and they tell you some things, but then it's the difference when you're now actually practicing the form. And I must say, you're
very early ones. First time. It'd be great for your husband, because one way with him and everything. Like,
priest, man, I don't like you no more, man. You know, made my wife. She got me on everything, man.
Well, like I said, I do want more people up. So before we go any further, we do this demonstration. Can I get two more hands and be up? All right, it's good. Big chirpy and good. All right, and maybe one more. I know I have a sister. Well, yeah. All right, good. All right, sister. And all right, any more? All right, cool. Because again, I want y'all to experience this. I mean, kind of be fun, but trust. This is a tool that you will use that will maybe save your life one day. And there's other tools I would give you. Again, a lot of you have gifts that all you need is the training, and it will unlock your abilities. Now, the key thing is this. Being descriptive, it's always the right hand has the, it's going to be palm down, but that's going to be, extremely white core, the red balloon. You see, those colors are vivid in the mind. So the red and the black, you don't have to do a blue, whatever. Also know this. Remember what I said. If you want to influence someone to make them slide more into a tranquil state, remember blue is the color that is used to have a calming effect. Why do you think sleeping pills are color blue? Why did you think Morpheus gave Neo the potential, the wake pill that was red? Red is stimulating, right? So be more descriptive. When I was telling your beloved wife, and she did this great, very well. I know y'all catch on. Plus, a lot of they actually had more stuff than y'all did, so that's why they kind of. I just haven't seen in a while, but they had some and stuff. So, but that's the key. I just want y'all to do this in practicality, and then, like I said, I'll give you other examples and then trust, and then be able to inject it into your everyday life. You know how you are dealing with certain situations. Whereas, like for instance, here's another trick. When you're dealing with an entity and a person is giving you a little hard time, like one time I had to deal with someone on the phone dealing with my cell phone some years ago, and we got to an argument. I'm a person, I'm getting an argument. So, remember I told you all the different brain waves? So when you make a sharp sound, it disturbs the mental brainwave, all right? That is also a millisecond that you can drop your suggestion in. So, I'm arguing person to my cell phone, whatever, I can't do this, sir. And I said, you're the person that I'm here. You're the person that I'm looking for to help. So the cute thing was, I made a sharp sound, and I kind of quickly delivered that suggestion, and it changed the whole conversation. And she was willing to do what I wanted, because I made a sharp sound, and slid my suggestion in. You're the person I'm looking for that can help me. That's why I came to you to help me with this issue. The whole conversation changed around. Before we know, we laughed and everything, and she gave me what I needed. So, you can see a demonstration of that with Darren Brown. Pull up Darren Brown. I keep saying Darren Brown because I want you to see in practicality. That's why I want you to do this. It was a thing where he went to a dog track race. And he told the guy to purposely pick a dog that will lose the race. The dog lost. So then he said, all right. He went to the counter and came back and got money on a losing ticket. He told him to do it again. He said, now I want you to go up. He said, believe this. But believe it in your soul and say that this is the winning ticket. So that's a great secret. When you make your statements, and that's what she was doing. She was believing as she was talking to him. I say authoritative, but you believe. He said, believe with deep in your soul, and you tell her, this is the winning ticket. So the guy came up, I can do the English, he said, this is the winning ticket. The lady said, gave you the trick. He walked up to the counter and said, this is the dog you're looking for. That's why we came to this window. You need to help us. Scan the ticket again. She scanned the ticket again. You know, it was the same losing ticket and paid out. Right?
another trip. But you got to do it in a sly way. And you might have a cup, or break the cup, or get a pencil, and make that slight sharp sound. Just sharp enough, make it look like it was a, you know, a mistake. Make a suggestion. Then you move from there and ask what you want. So again, believe in your soul when you give this. This is a simple demonstration. Another demonstration is usually done in Hindus. They always use a lemon and cut it. And they tell people just to think about the lemon before they know everybody's mouth is working. So, but this shows you how imagination can be the effect. So the key thing is, we're going to start from the beginning. You sit down. And you sit down. No, sit down. And you get her here.
Stand up, woman.
And she starts fighting. Matter of fact, Ali is Eric. I'm going. She starts swinging. I ain't getting to my Chinese move. I'm tap. Shang Shang.
Close your eyes.
Get back a little bit. It's funny, but you can't stand here. Remember the key thing is what? Simple stuff. Stand here. Oh, yeah, push your hands behind you. You know, your sides. And say, oh, look over here. Now, look this high. What am I doing?
Yes.
All right, so now. Because remember now, you ain't always got to say yes. It's a matter of the person complying and what you want them to do. You understand?
Hey, can you stand here for a moment?
A whole lot better, ain't it? I feel safe now.
All right, can you feel? Look at me right here. All right, close your eyes. Close your eyes. Just one second. And what I want you to do is focus on my voice. Follow every instruction. You feel safe, you feel calm, relax, take a few deep breaths, breathe in, and out. Now raise your right hand, palm down, slowly. Now imagine for me in a moment, a red and white string is hanging tied to the wrist. And with that is a balloon full of helium that is rising and rising and rising. Raise your left hand. Palm up. In this hand, there's a black bowling ball that's about 50 pounds. And you feel that weight pressing down on that hand. And it's getting lower and lower and lower and lower. And the balloon with helium is getting higher and rising and rising and rising and rising.
Paperwork to other entities, the This is your idea. And it's just a matter of you conveying properly the idea for them to be able to accept it. And I am so proud to hear y'all, because I was the only one over 25 years ago where everybody was saying, "Go on, ain't that?" And I kept saying, I was one of the white collar workers. I said, "We indigenous." I was the one saying Native American, because I knew on both sides of my family and in young we are called Cherokee. And now to see that y'all made comments is great. Is this is why I'm giving you these tools. So then you now see what I'm saying, so that when you're talking to these individuals, here's another key. Learn this phrase. When they're trying to give you and shove down your throat their idea, but no, this is going to say no. The issue isn't that. The issue is this. That's your phrase. The issue isn't that. The issue is this. You understand what I'm saying? The issue isn't that. The issue is this. This is why I'm giving you power words. I would love for the bluff, the beautiful sister back there, look like the singer, look like Chaka Khan. No, what do y'all got to say up here? What do y'all got to say up here? I want to give y'all power words that do have effects. I did it before, and there was a whole lot more. Who's a good people? There she goes. All right, now who's going to stay up here to be her pride?
Yes. Right. You got some other people that had their hands up, so
you
might
not. Yeah, because we're going to, you know, we're going to definitely do that. I want to give you power words. And then there's also phrases, too. All right, I gave this before, and here's some of the power words. These words need to be worked into your conversation. And the word is this. Here's nine of them. The first one is as, the next is because, the next one is naturally, the next one is easily, the other one is means, incredible, yet, powerful. And check this phrase out. Look into my eyes. All right. The other phrase is, you might even laugh, once upon a time. Right. We'll give you the other words in here. So we're giving, as, because, and, naturally, easily, means, powerful, quickly, incredible, don't sit down yet, and into my eyes. Now those are just a few, because I got some more. We're going to go with this now. You see how it was done, right? Now let's switch this. Now, you're going to be able to sit down. She's going to break. Now, again, as you see, what I did was, when I said to you, in order to influence a person, you got to get up and do what? Yeah. The mic, where you got to get up and do what? Five things. Right, so standing up is one is your mic. Get people here. Yeah, it's up. Yeah, it's my English has to be loud. So, one of the things is just him asking him to stand up and to stand in a certain place. That's one of the five things you need to do to make a person susceptible. You understand what I'm saying? So again, to take you back more. So when you're chilling, taking you back, turn through stuff, being on the book or whatever. What are you doing? You're giving the paperwork. And then you might even just say, just the hell of it. The paperwork I submitted to you, getting paid, turning page two. That's giving them an instruction. And you formulate it to ask others that they will do. Oh, by the way, can you give me a glass of water if you don't spill the paper? This could be the magistrate. Before you know it, you done got them up to five just basic little things. And before you know it, now you're darn near putting in your hand. It's just a matter of you now. And you go into what you're doing. So you see what I'm saying? I'm giving you these tools to apply what you're using. Everything you deal with is an idea, and you're just presenting it to other people. So again, your idea is to get him to what? Now, you have to speak up. Check your voice. Yes. You don't have to incorporate them yet, but if you can, you know. Matter of fact, yeah. You want to say, all right, can you stand up? And do this naturally. Now, matter of fact, introduce yourself.
My name is.
Any other questions? All right, cool. So, everybody got the name. So now you're asking him to give. Talk with authority. That's the key thing. You have to talk with authority. You don't have to be all boisterous like Vince and get up warm and that was fun for that. I'm scared though. But I know if I'd have done it with my fiance, I came back like home. Y'all would have had a scene where he's talking man, boy stuff, talking about all his wife. Then, ooh, you bad. You have to talk with authority, see? Because I know you're free. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, you get over here like, and you don't jump here in the door. You know, you want to do the same thing, so that's the key thing. You know, then you talk to you, talk about, you know, to your friends. You know, just talk in a normal voice. You know, I want you to stand here and put your feet together, put your hands down. These are just key basic things you're telling them to do, but instead of complying. So not all the time you want them to say yes, you can just get them to do something still saying yes. It's still getting you open. Because you can have master because they ain't gotta have you say yes, they can just say, hey, you stand here, look me in my eyes right here. Oh, not that eye, this side. Brother, oh shit, scared. You turn your head over to the side before you know it, and then say, oh, man, sleep.
No word.
But yeah, matter of fact, what you just seen me do, you may not do it tonight, but you're going to be the person that you can't do this because it's going to be a simple job. So try it out. So, again, just talking with authority, but it's projecting. I know you're not shy, I know you're going to have you here, but you're my family. This is a skill that's going to help you. This is kind of, matter of fact, any of you who are singers or what have you, because I used to be a hip-hop dancer, and I model, so I used to teach people how to work with models all the presence. This is part of that, presence and charisma. All right? One of my other tricks before I go any further, I told y'all, get a magnet or a lodestone. And I said, sit down, and you want to tell him
basic stuff. This is, it's got to be in succession. You can't let too much time go. Got to be in succession. Stand here.
All right. Put your feet together.
Yeah, stand together. And look at me. And you say, look at my arm. Put your hands down to the side. You know, just relax. Remember I told you the anchors? So you can touch on the hand, or touch on the shoulder, or the neck, or the forehead. These are key places that are also hypnotic. Also at the back of the neck, too. You don't do that. I love you. Yeah. Don't be a hot cast note. All right. So again, it's just a basic thing to tell them to do. Then keep thinking, remember the left hand with the palm up. That's going to hold the object, the heavy, the black. And the other one is down. It's cool. And make sure you get into the description. It's lighter. Keep going back. It's causing internal confusion. Lighter, this side, you know, this side. And that's what you want to keep going back. The key thing is when you're closing your eyes, it's cutting away your stimulus because you already know you got five senses. So now they're focusing, they have to focus on your ear, you know, what they're hearing. But close out before you do that. So at least cut that down. But I'm going to give you tools that you go on. I'm going to ask you, we're going to ask you to get all the black eye stuff in your hands where you want to be, you know what I mean? You can't go, close your eyes, Doug. I am now hypnotizing you. Doug. Now, see, this is where, oh, shoot, you know, messed up. I think I am going there. You can't, you know what I mean? But work it right. Work it right. Paperwork, you know, just basic little things. They say, yeah, if you can turn the page to 2, you know. Oh, no, it's actually not 2, actually 3. It's actually in the middle, and they follow you. You can do that 5 days on consecutive things. So that means actually you're purposely making them do mistake things because that's not really what you wanted. You just want them to keep doing yes eternally and not saying yes. You understand? Here's my answer. All right, brother, stand over here. Brother. All right. Oh, and here's the secret of hypnotic gaze, too. When you're staring at someone, this is when you hear them say, staring at me, it's like he's staring through me. Well, this is our secret. I'm not actually looking at you. I'm actually looking 6 feet beyond you. So that's why I look like I'm going to stare at you like a cobra. And before you know the effect. So remember that secret. Remember that secret. So when you're looking at somebody, just basically, you know, impress. Keep giving you secrets. I know these magicians don't have a problem with me. These people will pay $1,000 by convincing me it was honest and ridiculous. Say, hallelujah. I just want to say something. That's how I just made that up. Say it to me. Because he's got to hear me. I'm ready to step out the way because I don't think he's going to be like this, baby. He's going to be like, pretty. He's going to be like, all right, you want me to do? He ain't going to hear you. No, it's the mic is on, baby. Just,
you know. Hello. How are you? Hi, how are you doing?
You know, I want to move on. Delivered.
Yo.
Man,
your left hand is getting heavier and heavier
us to her voice. Mm-hmm. And that's all that is. That's just a demonstration. And that's just the balloon and the balloon and the bowling ball. There's other ways you can say that. There's other, you can say the hot and cold and what have you. You know, there's the other test where you can have like a card and have somebody hold it and tell them they hold it so hard, you know, that they can't move before, you know, they can't. Like, oh my gosh, so even arm stiffness. So it's many different ways. I want to keep giving you those things. But I wanted you to experience that. You don't really speak much in public, do you?
No.
But you did good.
Wow.
I figured since I got her, she seems the shyest. Like, it should be easy. Everybody should be coming. Me next. Excuse me next. I just want y'all to experience this and I'll keep dropping more to you. Now, why y'all decide that, Noah, I like your name, you'll take the mic. Do you want to? Or.
Give a hand over here.
All right. So remember, project your voice. And that's another superpower women have anyway, is the, you know, the banking voice. Sweet voice, which affects us, you know, any strong, heterosexual man, that will affect him very good. So, you know, and you got a problem, you got some extra deliverance, and the other way, you ain't gonna listen. You know, but nonetheless, that is your superpower, word that, but still put energy and authority behind it. Before you leave, I want you to get the power chant that I had gave as part of your ritual. I want y'all to say before you do your prayers or ritual or anything you do before you walk out your house. Now you do your prayer, you go to Islam, Allah, Father, Universe, Father, Glove, QB, Green, Judge, and that's your prayer. You put on like your cloak and shield. Well, the power chance I'm giving you that I have already given builds your power, your aura power. It sets your vibration, so make sure you get that because again, you're gonna be dangerous if you're not already. A lot of things going crazy over here, but you still need to project that voice.
Over
here. Who's going to be next? And I'm going to read off the other power words.
Did he say his name Noah? I mean, is that really his name Noah?
My name is Noah, yes.
Noah?
Okay. All right. Now, here are other hot words to enchant. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Achieve. Adore. Advice. Alluring. Let me backtrack. I was trying to tell y'all before, beautiful sister Hanson and Tara, the word because is powerful. They did an experiment. They did this. A little focus group. They actually, over here.
No, you're good.
They actually used the word because. This is what they did. They had a woman and a man take and go into a, you know, grocery store to get in the checkout line. And they said, the key thing is to see if you, the people can let you jump them. The key word you want to use is because. So they had like one or two items, and they said, you know, we want to see if you can use it. So they would say, all right, excuse me, is it all right if I get ahead of you, you know what I mean? Because I'm in a kind of rush, you know, because, you know, I only have like one or two things. And they're like, oh, yeah, I'm sure. And so anyway, when they did that experiment, they had a good 75% success rate. Now imagine, it may have been with a double blind, but imagine if it was you who I'm giving you the tools, if they're getting 75% success rate, imagine what you're going to get from these tools I'm giving you. Please get the hypnotic gaze. And these power words I'm giving you, these are words that you just add into, you know, what we're doing here. All right, the other word is automatically, avalanche, colorful, colossal, comfortable, compelling, daring, dazzling. Instantly, joy, know-how, mind-blowing. I want to stop here because we want to get this moving, and then I'll read the other intermission. So the two brothers here can now demonstrate. So These are ones you want to kind of.
Yes.
No, I have the two here. They're here. Okay, they just got to stand up.
Okay,
you didn't. Yeah, I know some more is going to come, but I'm just saying, I want to pause and I can read these later. I know you'll want to do the demonstration. I want to try to get as many of you to demonstrate just to get kind of familiar with it. And the good thing is, I'm putting out the subliminal that y'all are not picking up, that I gave y'all extra confidence. Because guess what? You performed this among people. And it ain't even only the number of people here. There's other people out there that's watching. So you doing that now, imagine when you go home and you run it back in your mind and you start practicing it, then you definitely won't have no problem doing it one-on-one with someone else. Yes?
I noticed you change a different tone of voice. What's the
pattern?
Pop, yeah.
Remember what I said. You got to believe in your soul. Here is the best I can describe it, and I'm going to do it. This is where my comedy histrionics come in. Because I can do the different voices, but also know this, you're going to have to develop not only a regular voice, but your hypnotic voice. So I'm talking to you like this, but also I've been doing this for years, so even my regular voice is my hypnotic voice, even though now I'm sliding into my hypnotic voice, and each and every one of you, as you blink your eyelids, you kind of feel a little woozy, a little dazed, relaxed. But I'm just sliding you all into a heightened synchronicity state of mind. Your luck, what would you call your field of luck, is augmented. You feel joy, you're happy, you're coming on the same rewards in your mind and your skill. Practice. And you can even put power behind your regular voice. Even though I refer you to certain movies and everything, it's to get your mind thinking, so your imagination. Your imagination is very powerful. Your subconscious mind is very powerful. Or you hear that old saying, if you can perceive it, you can achieve it. You've already done it when you walked into the room saying you're Moshe Mermin. It's just coming to know your nationality, to take back your pedigree. So you already see yourselves correcting your name. Y'all use the term status, and I might have, but you know, 5 years from now, you're wearing a turban and your fez, like a storm, and you're more like the beloved cherub here. He's truly a war. He's in his garb also, and he's chilling. Because he saw it, he perceived it, he achieved it. And it's nothing natural. Same with the system. Same with you, sister. Same with you. 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 So yeah, when you calm your voice down and you intently speak to someone, it does bring the situation down. So you might even, this is why I say I'm giving you skills, it might even save your life. You might be in a situation, somebody, you know what I mean? And you're like, oh, wow. Like, brother, you know, just calm down. You know, just calm down. You know, just think a little bit, you know, just calm down. Think of our next thought. And this could be a situation, like I say, you could have gone with. But this could be a skill that literally can talk you out of keeping your life kept. This is a useful skill. It's like I always say, calmer heads prevail. The calmer head is the one that knows what to say in a calm voice before you know it. You're going to calm that one person down. That was the assailant. You'd be very surprised with the skill. It depends on the skill of the hypnotist. That they can literally sit here and say, I want you all to be very relaxed and open. And just like the pages of this book, it's turning natural. Going in pace with the eyelids each time you blink. the template. A lot of things I will repeat. We have the other class. The sister has this, where she now has a meeting once a month on the last or the fourth Friday, like this. So, again, there's literature and all that backs this. So I want the brothers to come up and do a demonstration in this way. There's two more that want to do it, because I want to try to do as much as possible. I want y'all to get this skill. Now, it's going to be so funky. You're young. How old are you, beloved?
I'm 17 right now.
By the time he's 25, the brother going to be a giant. He's going to be a juggernaut like this. And by the time you get my age, you're going to be a master. You might be doing some of the things I'm telling y'all. Because I'm going to give y'all the tools. If y'all have them, I may be long gone. But you might be a master before you know. You have somebody come in the door, you just say sleep, and they just drop. And there's individuals that can do that. That's why I say I'm giving you pieces of what they call black hypnosis. Black ops hypnosis. So I'm just getting to the point of it. So again, Brother Noah, Cherub, standing up, and you want to direct the gentleman, Brother Moore.
How are you? How are you? What's your name? It's Hassan.
Hassan.
Hassan? Yes.
Can you please get up here for me, Hassan?
Indeed.
All right, like that. All right, you can do it.
Can you please straighten up your feet, Hassan? And have your hands like they are. Can you please close your eyes? Please put up both of your arms. Your right arm, of course, palm up. And your, can you please flip your hands around? Yes, thank you. Okay. So, in this hand, you have a balloon full of helium, and it's red, white string. This one, you have a 30-pound bowling ball. It's getting heavier and heavier. But the balloon is also getting very light. Very, very light. You can feel the balloon drifting over to the air. But then the bowling ball is also getting heavier and heavier to the ground. Very quickly, actually. The bowling ball seems like it's heavier than the balloon, clearly. But the balloon is also getting higher and higher and higher up in the air. It's almost reaching a few of the butterflies that are flying near you. But the bowling ball is also getting heavier. It's almost reaching down to a pit bull that you see running across. So, what I want you to do now is open your eyes. Look.
When you see the distance between the hands, all that's indicating, that's great. He captured Brother Hassan's attention. Mm-hmm. And that's the key thing. Whatever you convey, you want to capture the attention of the individual. All the arm distance is just showing you the physical result of how he listened. And again, I don't want you to sit up here and pretend and what have you. You should be literally just almost blank and just listening. And when he's causing the confusion, he's going back and forth with the two things going on. That's what caused the internal conflict, and the body's going to respond. So that's generally what that is. And I like the fact you threw a little extra stuff in there. See what I'm saying already? He just got the tools and he just threw in extras of little butterfly.
For some reason, when I was little, I used to do stuff like that. So,
see, and I was just using an example that, again, this is why I'm saying I love the fact that y'all bring the young cherubs here, because even though you might do things and they may be crying, they're young, or you keeping them a little occupied, they're still absorbing this.
Yes, ma'am.
And it's great. And I just said it, and yet he proved it. And I thank you so much again, beloved one. I just want to see you more. Because I just said it, and you demonstrated it. You just, and it was natural. You know, it wasn't so much of a fumble, but it was natural for you. You threw in the butterfly in his name. So you got the key thing. The key thing is to strike the imagination in the individual. All Christ and the brother and son. I know you want it. If you want to switch, or is it someone else that you want to do? Yeah. I just want more of you to try to get this. I'm going to do my inner thing here right on the side to give you the other words. All right, the other words is this: miracle, money, mouth-watering, secure, seductive, sensual, serious, shocking, simple, sour, sizzling, special, skyrocket, snowball, startling, step by step. All right. So the next brother and sister, you want to arrange who wants to do what? I'm going to also repeat by the end of that. Key times whenever you're doing some influence, there's a more brother I'm kind of aiding spiritually in a legal situation, but I want to reiterate to you the optimal times when you are doing your prayer and you're trying to influence. The best times is 6 a.m. to 10 a.m. Here are the other times: 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. and then the 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. And here's when you really, really need to influence somebody, and it's really more optimal. It's between the 12 a.m. to 3 a.m. because usually people are resting. All right? That's if you have to focus on someone. All right? So, beloved, you've seen the basic pattern. Go ahead and begin. I just want to give you
one. I'll try.
Okay. And I thank you again. I just want to say I appreciate it again, because I know to y'all, I'm one of the elder teachers or whatever, you know, where's that y'all came out and to even want to participate in taking this tool that I'm trying to hand to you. You know, I'm just coming back on the mainstream scenes from some of my very few rare appearances, because I usually treat, teach privately. But I do have literature and all the facts, so I'm just condensing it. And trust, this is rare literature that usually, you know, accumulated in hundreds of dollars, but we're just giving it to y'all basically almost pennies on the dollar. Just a matter of the system will calculate what she'll charge and what she won't charge on high fee, but you know, we're making it available. Again, this is truly the house of awakening minds. So we're just trying to give you the science. This is stuff that my Masonic brothers and you say the brothers in the Adam chain and all that, they ain't want this. So you want it, it's here. I'm just thankful again. Thank you for demonstrating to just take this tool and showing me you got it. So I'm thanking you so much. It warms my heart that you want to do this. I just want to say that to show appreciation. Go
ahead.
All right.
You get each other's names? I'm about to work.
Hey, Greece, how are you? I'm Hassan, you are?
You say?
E-I-L? Okay, let me know if I'm spelling it right. Is it I? How does it start off? Y-A-E-L? All right.
Y-A-S-S. That's actually gorgeous. Can you say it one second for me, please? Yeah. Am I pronouncing it right? Yeah.
Okay, is it Y? Is it A? Is it E? Is it L?
All right, God, I just want to make sure. Got
that. All right, here we go. I want you to pay attention to the sound of my voice. I want you to look right in my eyes. I want you to put your hands by your side firmly. I want you to raise both of your hands in front of you. Right palm down, left palm up. Close your eyes. Attached to your right wrist is a white ribbon. At the top of that is a red balloon filled with helium. In your left hand, it's a 30-pound bowling ball. Your left hand is getting slightly heavier. You feel the bowling ball. It's not as slippery as you thought. You can actually keep a grip on it, and it's getting heavier. In your right hand, the balloon is raising your right arm higher and higher. You can feel maybe a little strain on your wrist right here on, with the bowling ball, making it heavier and heavier. And you can feel a little less tension on your shoulder here from the balloon raising your hand higher and higher. You can imagine the bowling ball making your arm weaker, bringing it lower, almost at waist length. Your right hand now is going higher and higher, almost at shoulder length. I want you to focus on the weight of the bowling ball. It feels like it has increased now from 30 to 35 pounds. It's heavier. Your hand is dropping lower and lower. Your right hand with the balloon is getting higher and higher. The helium has raised your wrist above your shoulder. Open your eyes.
Especially you did the snapping, you know, also. Someone else? Again, I'm going to try to fit in as much as possible for, you know, before we chill out for the eve. And I know a lot of people are going to rush me and ask other questions. And I may have to go over. I did get the hit on engagement. I did go through that quickly.
Last class.
Yeah, but I'm saying for those new ones here. Is there someone else? Yeah. I thank y'all again for this participation, because again, the right word. I'm just giving to you, some may say word down, but it's a simpler version, and people usually pick up on the comments, which is basically in the center.
It's fine.
You know what I mean? So maybe that's why you are snapping it down.
You suggested Darren Brown, and I did meet anybody who suggested in the last class I watched, yeah.
Cool. So again, but I'm now seeing more of you being more open to participate. So that's good. So I just want you to learn this quick skill, and we might do it some other times. But there's another one too. I do want to do a focus. So we're gonna do this. Remember the pattern that he said. The key thing is we already seen he made you wrap your idea, your mind around this idea. The key thing is to go keep switching back and forth when it's possible. Just keep it smooth. Black ball is getting heavier. The balloon is getting lighter and lighter. The wrist is coming up with the white cord. You know, you just want to keep going back and forth. I see someone's adding a little creativity, because then, you know, this is where I say when you're studying your adjectives, you might throw them in there. Plus, I just gave you power words. I don't want to take up more time. Let y'all go ahead and have this. And once you two are done, I'm going to switch, you know, the end zone if possible. Suppose you're at a party and you're talking. Remember, I saw you and you talk to a person, And you know what I mean? So, as you're talking to them, you can touch the shoulder and what happened. And also add to it. So, you're doing good. Just, you know what I mean? Because, again, you know you're not going to be that way when you get what you're getting. You know how you are. More we know. Get up here, you tell people, try to tell you black, you're like, I am not black, I am most American. Don't let me read you, and then it's whatever, I love you, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you know, put that little bit in, and that little funny words. So you're doing good. I'm not gonna, you know, I'm just saying, you know, jazz it up, use the other things I you'll leave always a lasting impression with people.
Imagine your left hand has a white string attached to it that has a red helium balloon, and your right hand has a heavy bowling ball that's about 30 pounds. And you just imagine that your right hand is getting heavier and heavier. And your left hand has a white string and a red helium balloon that's getting higher and higher. And the
right
hand. Right hand.
Right hand balloon,
left hand bowling ball. Gotcha. Your left hand is getting heavier and heavier, and your right hand is getting higher and higher as the balloon is going higher and higher. And your right hand is getting heavier and heavier, and your left hand is getting higher and higher. And your left hand, right hand is getting heavier and heavier.
I still thank y'all. If not, I'll move it on because I do want Brother Man to have his experience. Anyone else would love to go up?
Brother Ray.
Oh, yeah.
Think right light. It's light and
yeah, dark. There you go.
Yeah. Right light.
That's cool. Yeah. So you're doing good, you know. And this is why we have this, and I appreciate you, and I thank y'all so much. Because you obviously now see this skill that you can use. And yeah, just remember the left. You say, like you said, light, right, that's good. And you know, remember. So the key thing is you just basically getting a different thing. Even if you was to just say it's another way of bearing. You can just say one hand, the right hand is under a flame. Mm-hmm. And it's just getting warmer and warmer and warmer. And then you saying the left hand is now in an ice bucket and it's getting cold and cold. See how that is? And if you were to do that, trust, you will get a result. His hand will get a little hot, especially when you throw him under, he'll start having blisters on his hand and the other hand will get clammy because you're not listening. But we're not going to do that. We're just doing the lighter, easy. Key thing is you already understand is to keep the confusion with your problem. So just remember, you know, like she said, so you're doing good. Just do it again.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay,
would you keep that up, please?
Thank you.
Close your
eyes. Pounds. The bowling ball is heavy.
another powerful phrase. It might not seem much to you. Y'all may have heard me say this.
Y'all may have say, heard me say this. This is another phrase. It's a very powerful phrase. And that phrase is this. Everything I say will now become your reality fully and completely. That is a very powerful phrase. Again, that is like a super suggestion to be used. So if you were in the middle of doing the demonstration like y'all did with the ball and the balloon, as you were ad-libbing and putting in there, you could have actually through this thing by saying, the red balloon is tied to your right wrist. It's causing your right arm to go up and up. It's a spin of light, right, wide, left. Pulling the golden ball is getting heavier and heavier. And the morning is getting heavier, the light is getting lighter. And then everything I say now will become your reality. Full and completely. Here's another person using mass hypnosis in history. You have to look at history to know what I'm saying. This guy was a monster in history. He was actually at his birthday a couple days before mine. And the Germans hailed him as their head Nazi leader, Hitler. Hitler understood the laws that I gave you, and he had said that people are stupid. In his book, My Kampf, meaning My Struggle, he said people are stupid. You keep repeating something over and over, they'll believe it. This is what he used to do in his speeches. They would assemble. He would do this. Sometimes, doing something hypnotic doesn't always have to be in action. He would do this. That he would be unruly. You know how you go into concerts or gatherings and people just talking and they're unruly? He would just do this. Some of the things I want to finish up, but I still can't even get to all. But the good thing is, at least I got to do a demo and I got to give you the pieces of its skill. And when I have my next session, we're going to add more to that. Trust this will give me that strong urge to want to come out and get more of this. Holy Covenant of Asiatic Nations, chapter 25, is always read. The beginning and the end of our worship order around here in the meeting. And some of y'all will say classes. I don't say classes. I say this is a sermon class. Because a lot of individuals need this spiritual work. This Holy Covenant, the Asiatic Nation, is a reminder to us brothers and sisters when we are here in the world and how we conduct ourselves. There's one thing that is so disgraceful to see now you being grown and seeing some of the prophecy that the prophet had said that, you know, we had to be careful when the wars were turning the fence on, trying to put you back in the slavery. And the other negative thing that's going on, the prophet had never been a liar, but, you know, it's a shame for me to live and see some of these things. But this chapter was very important, and as to why the prophet made sure it was in your soul, it's like the Quran. Again, as I said earlier, I have the source material of scripture, which we will eventually have that available to us, to that scripture called Infinite Wisdom. And if you find it in your hands, you'll see the other chapters, and you'll see these chapters where it came from, and then you will see evidence of what the prophet said. I took what I needed to help you get out of your condition. He also said, go leap beyond these doors to get true. You know, the half hasn't been told. If I tell you everything, you get people to go back to sleep, and he's not lying. That was one thing that we always had to deal with, that sometimes we gave too much information to people and they go back to sleep. So a lot of the literature and stuff that y'all got from my father and us, from the Emotional Roundtable, and then the books that I have, which is the other portions of two Emotional Roundtable lessons, this is decades of research in the sacred world that we put our names on the line and we were considered rogues and outcasts, renegades back in the 90s. But now y'all got to set the fingertips. Y'all coming in the door with more knowledge than Adams have been in there for decades. Just don't be arrogant with it. I always tell y'all, when you say go to the temple, be a part of the temple, be in my dad's name, which is kind of like good, or Madoff, be him, so it's the word better than blood. Our name is Madoff to, you know, everybody in the temple. They don't like Todd, they don't like Hannibal, you know, because we give it truth and science. But trust, what we did tonight, that's something that will be taught to you in the attic chamber. That's something that will be taught to you in the Masonic Lodge. And definitely, that's just the beginning skills. Like I said, you got some people teaching the basic hypnosis. You got at least 300, 500 for a weekend. But let me give you that. There's just more to it. I chunked it. Gave you a lot of stuff. This is to remind you, brothers. I don't get along with you. The Holy Covenant of the Asiatic Nation. Ye are the children of one father, provided for his care, and the breast of one mother has given you suck. Let the bonds of affection therefore unite thee with thy brothers, and that peace and happiness may dwell in thy father's house. And when ye separate in the world, remember the relation that bindeth you to love and unity, and prefer not a stranger before thine own brother. If thy brother is in adversity, assist him. If thy sister is in trouble, forsake her not. So shall the fortress of thy father contribute to the support of his holiness and his care be continued to you all in your love for each other. And here, Assalamu alaikum.
Well, thank you so much. Come on. There's a mic.
Thank you. For everybody used to talk. Now we all feel we can be free. What is it y'all
I just want to say officially, and I think you mentioned it, that now officially we're going to have Father Hannibal on the fourth Fridays. He will be here on the four Fridays, so there won't be the Saturday sessions. We will have the four Fridays now. So now, you know, because I know you guys, it's kind of hard, especially since most of you come from out of state to come on a Friday and then turn around and then come, you know, back to back on the Saturday. So we hope we can, you know, pack the place out on the four Friday and, you know, really you know, keep this going. Again, thank you so much. Give yourself a round of applause for your faithfulness and your dedication. And thank you. Thank you to the Facebook. Thank you to the Facebook audience. We thank you so much.
And to that album, Reeves, you Fruity Pebbles.
I'm closing out now.